Welcome everyone to the 152nd edition of the Nut House podcast, brought to me by BoxerSam.com. I'm your host, Andy Patterson, who's recovering from the worst hangover known to the human race since Friday night. With me today, I've got Adam Smith, Donny Baseball will be around at some point. Alex Morris is going to be the same. We've got Kurt Ward, Steve Wellens, Tommy Allen and Dave the Hater Loback. Now, I don't know who to go to first, actually. I'm trying to remember who's the big Cottle lover here and who's the big Cottle hater now. Tommy, I had to tell people you were going to be off the pod today, but here you are. You did think last week he was going to get destroyed. I think it went how much, pretty much, as I said it was. 171-11 on my scorecard. John McKee did the same. Dave Moretti, 119-109 is a bit wide. 118-110 to another card. Some people were even saying maybe only Canelo by a point. Did you have it as wide or even close as that?
I had it 8-4. I thought Canelo, although it was competitive, I thought he was in control straight through the fight. I didn't think he was ever in danger of losing it. He was landing the bigger shots. He was landing the meter punches. He was a stronger guy. I seen a few people saying that Cotto was robbed. That's really, really far off the mark. That's just as bad as obviously some of the scorecards were. I thought that Canelo might have put him away, yeah, but I thought he'd done a good job. It was a professional job. He's got the title now and onwards and upwards. What did Cotto do again last night after the fucking decision we had? He just left, didn't he? And well, people wonder how we don't. I didn't like the guy. He just makes none excuses all the time. He's classless in defeat, man. I just can't stand him.
See, you talk about like Cotto making excuses and stuff. So these fans, I mean, some of the comments I see, I mean, like Margarito had cement, Cotto would have beat him if he didn't have the cement in his hands and stuff. What was the other one? Pacquiao was in roids, Cotto was drained at 145, even though he made 146 like 3 months before in his last fight. They had an off night against Austin Trout. I just think the simple fact you can do it is you've got a guy here who is not a bona fide middleweight. We know that about the catch weights. I think it was a competitive fight to some sort of degree, maybe about 4 or 5 rounds. I think that's when, I wouldn't say Canelo's size won him the fight entirely. That's to be unfair, because he did show some good defence, some good head movement, and some good power punches as well. I just think any time that Canelo landed these shots, either fucking Cotto either went on the run. He started that shitty shadow defence move once he puts the hands up after he's fucking already received the punch, or he's going to go and reset himself. And that's exactly what he did. I just think that the power Canelo kept him more than honest, whereas anything he landed on Canelo was, honestly, he walked right through it. And people are noogling on about the fact cut about how I think people are saying that Cotto landed the more punches in the fight, therefore it was a closer fight and it should have been closer in the cards. Do you agree with that? What was your scorecard?
I think I had it the same as Tommy. 116-112. I don't think it was close really at all. It was, Cotto was competitive. It's not like it was totally one-sided. He had, his moments, but it's a simple fact that, the punches he was landing just had no impact at all on Canelo. It was just, Canelo just looked confident throughout. He looked like he knew he had the fight sewn up, to be honest. I mean, two of the rounds I gave Cotto were, I think, the 10th and 11th, where Canelo just literally did nothing. And it was like he, I don't know if he was tired or he just felt he was so in control he was allowed to do it. And then he came out in the 12th and really, threw more leather. But it was just a size thing. Cotto really, I mean, credit to him. He gave his best account that he could, I thought. He wasn't, like, totally listless like he was against Trout. But, what could he do? He was landing his flurries that did nothing. He couldn't really stand and trade because the power and the strength was with Canelo. So then he had to bounce about on his feet, which in the end it was just mostly the same thing with Canelo walking him down and, landing the spiteful punches. But I was actually, I was impressed with Canelo. I think some of his feints that he did, one when he went to the jab to the body, then the right hand over the top, or the feint with the right hand to the head and then the lead uppercut. I mean, some of those moves were really nice. He was throwing some nice body shots as well, and I think his upper body movement has really improved. I mean, he made Cotto miss quite a lot. It's like it was always going to be a tough ask for Cotto. I never felt that he really could win the fight, to be honest. But I've got to say, he gave a good account of himself, and he wasn't really hurting there. And I was expecting Canelo to maybe stop him, and maybe he could have down the stretch. But I just think his stamina again played a part, and he was looking tired towards the end, I felt.
Dave, I know you kind of defend Cotto at times, but I think we need to really start a hashtag going here just now and pray for Freddie Roach. The poor guy's going to be homeless after that defeat last night. He bet his two houses on that.
I had no idea he made a bet on the fight. But, I mean, he's got other guys still in the game, and he's a renowned trainer that I'm sure a lot of people are going for. Even apparently Ronda Rousey, he's offered her help. she certainly needs it.
No, definitely. But awesome. Was that a robbery last night?
No. It wasn't a robbery. Well, wait. The cards, with the wideness of the cards was absurd. And that was, I mean, you could class that as a robbery because that was just ridiculous. I think I would say 116, 112, Canelo to a draw are fair. I thought it was close. I didn't score it every round. I felt a close fight to me by the end of it. Maybe 7-5. Canelo, but I was not impressed by Canelo at all. He's still the same ginger hype job who got schooled by Floyd Mayweather. Difference last night was he wasn't weight trained to 152. He was allowed to come in at roughly what he wanted, although I heard apparently he did have trouble making the weight regardless, even though it was his favorite 155 weight that he wants to drain Golovkin down to. I thought he looked massive in there. He had the huge size advantage, he had the youth, he had the speed advantage. And he still couldn't even drop Cotto. He couldn't put him away. He didn't make a statement last night, in my opinion. I mean, Cotto looked old and sluggish and small. And, I mean, I was not really impressed with either guy. But, I mean, Cotto, I thought, boxed better. And being that he was at a significant disadvantage, from my perspective, I think I was more impressed by Cotto than I was with Canelo, even though Canelo probably won the fight.
But Dave, I mean, speaking from, you know, you didn't hurt him, do you think he maybe showed Cotto too much respect?
I just think he was tired. I mean, he looked tired by the 11th and 12th round. And in the 11th especially, he was just throwing wild. He looked like an idiot. And he would just throw single punches at a time. I still think his stamina is an issue. And maybe he was wary of looking stupid because Cotto did make him miss a lot of times. And, I mean, it just looks bad when that happens. So maybe he didn't. Was he respectful of Cotto's power? I don't think so, because Cotto caught him clean a couple times. Couldn't seem to hurt him at all. I think Canelo has a good chin, and with the size difference, it was even more apparent. I don't think Cotto really had any chance at all to hurt him last night.
I would agree with that, because I think he was showboating, but I guess Conor did say to him that, listen, you're getting a bit kind of cocky here because he's catching you a couple of times. But Tommy, I want you to respond to that. He's claiming that Canelo is overhyped still.
He's a hype job.
You look at the guy's resume, the age he is, what he's done in the sport at the time. If he's a hype job, then pretty much every fighter runs a fucking hype job, aren't they, man, you know? Canelo's absolutely a tremendous young fighter.
He underwhelms us every time. Lara, could have lost that fight. I thought he should have lost to Trout. Wow, he beat Kirkland in impressive fashion, but not quite as impressively as Nobuhiro Ishida, so, wow, big deal. That's what I think.
Everybody's waiting, I'm going into this, to be this seek and destroy fighter all the time, that, isn't he? That's no style. Canelo's a boxer. He's a great combination puncher, don't get me wrong. When he hurts somebody, he can put him away, but he's a boxer. I thought the Trout fight was a draw, but let's be honest, the open scoring, that affected the performance of the Canelo in that fight. I think if the scores had been tighter, he had another gear to go up. He just boxed a finisher. He knew his miles in front. I thought he won the Lara fight. And yeah, you know, obviously won last night. I'd like to see him. I think he's just top quality. To me, that last night was a big junior middleweight against a welterweight. I think we all know that Cotto's only a welterweight, but he's still got the job done in the end, and he's got the title now. Hopefully, he mans up and faces Golovkin, which I think he will. You've got to give the guy credit. He's taking on everybody. Everybody says that Canelo's going to avoid this guy. He's going to avoid that guy. He's got in with everybody. Everybody that people have said he'll avoid, he's been in with everybody, fought Mayweather, fought the best in the world, Lara, Trout, you know, Cotto, you need to give him credit, man. Eh?
Steve, I know you had it slightly closer, mate. I had it 117-111, but the rounds I did give Cotto, I mean, you know, they were quite close rounds, and there were some rounds in there that you could possibly say were close and could have swung either way. I think the only round I could probably give Cotto clearly was probably round 8.
Yeah, I think I thought it was a bit closer, but I think closer than the scorecards suggested. Maybe a 116-112 was fair enough. I don't think there was any danger of Cotto winning the fight, but I agree pretty much with Dave's assessment. I think it was a lot closer. Maybe Box Nation was swaying me. Barry Jones seemed to... I think he had, you know, it all on the line towards the last couple of rounds, and I'm not saying it was that close, but I wouldn't say I was disappointed with Canelo, because I like him, he's a good fighter. The stamina could still be an issue, I do believe that. He was maybe pacing himself a little bit, but watching him in there last night, it struck me that there seems to be two phases to the way Canelo fights. It's defense or attack, and they're like separate entities. If you're watching like a Golovkin or a Roman Gonzalez or somebody like that, they tend to mix the two. Whenever they're coming in, the head's rolling, while he's throwing the punches, he's ducking from your punches while he's attacking you. But Canelo, he's either throwing and leaving himself open, or he's stepping back and picking at you while rolling the head with that lovely defense. Really nice movement, but there's no smooth correlation between the two. He's either doing one or the other. And his head movement was excellent last night. I really liked that. And the uppercut too. The uppercut was working really well. But I'm wondering whether if he could be vulnerable when he transitions between the two. And hopefully when he fights Golovkin, we'll see. And saying that, I think that Quillin and Jacobs, for example, would both be competitive with Canelo for a time, but he'd get to both of those guys. Golovkin's the only fight. It's the only fight we need to see now. And as for Cotto, I think he did himself okay. I've said it before, I'm not a Cotto hater. I've enjoyed his career. He was too small last night. Not enough power to hurt Canelo, which means that Canelo should have maybe planted the feet a little bit better and got him out of there. He was more like a bug. Cotto buzzing in and out. He was more style than substance. He wasn't really scoring big. And just regarding the Austin Trout fight, as Kurt said, I think the Trout fight was an anomaly when it comes to Cotto's career. I think it was a bit like Zahir Rahim when he fought Eric Morales. I think the style just didn't work for him on that night. And he's got a career to be proud of, but it's definitely at the end now.
If Cotto does retire, actually, I mean, Melissa will go with my most deepest regards. I mean, she was looking lovely there last night. I prefer Spaniel's ears breasts compared to those plastic foster tits that we get nowadays. So, well done, sweetheart. Adam, give me your take on your scorecard, mate. And just give me a take on the scorecard, and I'll come back to my second question. In fact, I'll just go to my second question at the same time. I'll maybe see if I can get you and Tommy at it here. But, you know, give me your scorecard. And give me the reason why, you know, why do these Cotto fans, sorry, these Canelo fans think it's reasonable to start with these fucking A-side excuses in regards to Golovkin? Absolute fire tree, mate.
I had it closer than most, actually. I'm probably going to get some hate. I scored the 10th round of draw. I don't like scoring draws, but scored the 10th round of draw, which made it on my card 115 to 114, so that was closer than most. But I was tweeting throughout. I thought, you know, I could feel a close fight on the cards. Obviously, I got that completely wrong, and the you know, the judges thought otherwise. They had it pretty wide, probably too wide. But I thought it was hard to score because Canelo wasn't doing that much for me. I wasn't impressed with him last night. I mean, I wanted him to win. I'm a bit of a Canelo fanboy. I've made that quite clear. But it did nothing. It did nothing to increase my fanboyism last night. You know, I've liked the way he's taken challenges since the Mayweather fight. He's not ducked any challenges. He's actually took a couple that he didn't have to. But last night, I just don't think he did all that enough. I think he was, you know, winning the middle rounds. I think I gave him, other than the 10th, I gave him a sweep. I gave him 10 points in each of the last four rounds. So, you know, he was coming on strong there, but he never looked like... It was quite a boring fight, really. No one was ever hurt. There was no real drama. There was no controversy. I was just a bit disappointed last night. I was a bit disappointed with the whole night as a whole, but we'll come on to that later. But
It wasn't a Gomez Sanchez Mexico Puerto Rico war, was it?
Aye, or like you said, Gomez but, against fucking.
Just in regards to the Golovkin stuff, I mean, I'm getting highly annoyed. Obviously, I'm a massive Golovkin fan, and no one wants to fight him. Now they're coming up with excuses. I mean, this time last week, some people wanted Canelo to win just for the good of boxing, which I thought was a fair point. You know, oh, Canelo will fight him. Tommy still thinks Canelo will fight him.
Of course.
But now, as the week went on, Oscar De La Hoya started planting seeds of doubt in everyone's mind. And, you know, oh, we want it at this weight, we want it at this location, I'm the A-side. What a load of crap. Just get on with it. I was watching it last night, and, you know, midway through the fight, I just thought that Golovkin, regardless of who the winner was, I thought Golovkin smashes both of them, and I think he will.
I agree with you. Golovkin does. I'm a huge Canelo fan. Everybody knows that. Golovkin will beat him. But Canelo is the side. If he wants to dictate a catch, wait, that's up to him. Gennady
Golovkin. You can't support it, though, mate. You can't support
it. I'm not supporting it, but people kind of turn around and say, well, he's just trying to drain Golovkin because fucking Golovkin doesn't seem to want reward. He said, I'll fight you, but I'll fight you at 164. So it's good for the goose, it's good for the gander, you know?
I think, you know, I've been critical of Canelo in the past, but I actually agree with Tommy. I think Canelo will fight him. He didn't have to fight Erislandy Lara in a fight that he knew, even if he won, he'd look bad in. He fought him because people wanted to see it. People were saying he was scared of him. I think they will fight Golovkin. I think Golovkin has to take the deal that he can. I don't think he can play a diva saying he wants this and that. He has to take that fight, fight Canelo on pay-per-view, beat him up and beat him on pay-per-view to become that star, because the Lemieux pay-per-view looked like it bombed. He can't be in a position. He might be in a position to dictate terms with someone like Andre Ward, who hasn't got, you know, hasn't got anything going for him right now. But with Canelo, I just think he needs that big fight. You got to do something like what a Winky Wright did years ago. Just take the fight that's offered. You might not get the best deal, but down the line, it'll probably be worth it in the end.
I want to see the fight. I want to see the fight at the full 160. But the state of boxing we're in just now, we're in the era of the catch weight. I think we've got to accept that now. That if there's a big A side in it, they're going to ask for catch weights and stuff like that. So we've just got to accept that.
Yeah, and Canelo knows what it's like. I mean, Mayweather did it to him, and he complained about it. But now he's in the position of being in the power of the A side. He's going to do exactly the same thing. He knows that.
Of course, yes.
He wants any advantage he can get, and that's the way that boxing is at the moment. But if a fight gets made, and I mean, I don't think Golovkin will have. I think Golovkin will make the catchweight easier than Canelo would. So I don't see the big deal with that, and I think he'll beat him anyway.
What I'm going to ask, why does Canelo even need catchweight? Cotto needs catchweight. He was almost an accidental winner of the middleweight title. Canelo doesn't need catchweight. Look at the size of Canelo.
I think it's just because there's an area of doubt. Oh. Golovkin's never been that low in weight. He says he can make the weight, Golovkin, but he's never been that low in weight. Maybe he will struggle. Maybe he'll botch the weight.
I really think Canelo's maybe got a wee bit more growing still to do. I think he's only 25.
Yeah.
Usually you hit your man strength, what, late 20s? Yeah. So I think he's maybe got a wee
bit. I think he's even bigger than Golovkin he could be.
He's a fucking midget. He's not a junior middleweight. There's no way that guy is a middleweight. I've stood next to him.
He's a light heavyweight when he comes in the ring.
Yeah, if you look at middleweights and that, though, they're all rehydrating to 180, 190 pounds. Canelo's but he's a small. Golovkin's a small middleweight.
Wait, one at a time. Tommy, mate, finish off.
As I was saying, he's a junior middleweight. See fucking Bernard Hopkins and all that. These are all big Gary Pavlik. These guys are middleweights. These guys are going up to 180 pounds, 190 pounds. Canelo's a junior middleweight. Golovkin. He fights a middleweight. He's not a big middleweight, though, is he? Come on.
I think you can't really call him a junior middleweight anymore when he can't make the weight. I don't think he can make that weight anymore.
What, you know, then he's saying is he's going to fight, Golovkin's going to fight him at his weight class. What is it, fucking Canelo weight now? Is it 155, 156?
I think
I agree with Kurt, though, that Golovkin has to just take it, suck it up, and beat the crap out of him, because he will anyway. And that's what's going to make him a star. But I don't think it's. I think they're about the same size. I don't think Golovkin rehydrates much higher than that. He's about a 170 in the ring.
See, with the weight thing, I mean, I don't know if you like watched the HBO broadcast, but Roy Jones was on about Rigondeaux wanting to fight, you know, maybe a future opponent for Roman Gonzalez at 118 catchweight, because both of them enter the ring as a featherweight. But it doesn't work like that. I mean, Pacquiao and Mayweather enter the ring around the same weight, but look at the size difference in the ring. I mean. Yeah. Roman Gonzalez might step in that ring at 126, same as Rigondeaux, but Rigondeaux will be the much bigger physically man. It's just the way it is, and I think Canelo might be bigger than Golovkin in the ring in terms of weight, but I think he's not naturally the bigger guy in that ring.
Well, if you look at it like this, right, weight and strength are two different things. I sometimes train my cousin, right? My cousin, he's lifting the new between 140 and 160 kilo. Now I've got 4 stone on him, and I can't lift that, so... I'm maybe heavier than him, but I'm not stronger than him, if you know what I mean. So, yeah.
On the subject of...
There he is. Alex, give me your scorecard first, mate, and then pile in whatever you're going to say there.
I had 116, 112 to Canelo.
Seems to be the norm.
I've seen a few for Cotto, and I just find it laughable. I don't see how you can score that to Cotto. I think that a draw, maybe, is the closest you can do. I mean, there were a lot of... just, especially the early rounds, there was just a lot of nothing rounds, nothing in it. I mean, they were doing CompuBox, and you know, they pretty much landed exactly the same punches. It's whether or not you liked, you know, the Cotto's defense a bit more, or the fact, you know, Canelo was plodding forward a bit better. And you know, I thought that Canelo just took over towards the end, even though he was very flat-footed, very singular style. I just think that Cotto was a bit too old and a bit too weary for it all. What I was going to say was about, you mentioned Golovkin wanting a catch weight from Ward, and the difference between Canelo wanting one and Golovkin wanting one is Canelo claims, well, has a middleweight title. Golovkin doesn't have a super middleweight title. He's got fair credit and fair reason for asking for a catchweight because he's not a super middleweight. But Canelo is a middleweight because he holds a middleweight title. And I do believe that the size of the bastard last night was fucking unreal. I reckon he does at least rehydrate bigger than Golovkin. Whether or not, you know, the strength is utilized in the same way, you know, it's a different issue entirely, like you mentioned. But I think that he's probably going to end up having to concede a catchweight anyway. But a catchweight of, like, you know, Canelo weight of 155 is just embarrassing.
No, that's too much. I think if anything, if he comes in below anything like 157, he can fucking forget about it. He'd look like Daniel Gill did.
I think 157 is...
Like Bergen Bells or some shit.
Yeah, I think 57 is what's going to be. I mean, like I said, if they wouldn't make that a 155, because Canelo, I don't think he wants to make that again. And I think if it's 157, I still maintain that Golovkin will make that easier than Canelo. I think Canelo is, you know, he doesn't want to make that weight anymore. But he knows that if he goes in at 160, then the slim chance that people may give him will not be there. I think he knows that in order to try and make it a fight, he's got to try and get any advantage he can. And just like with Golovkin with Ward, I mean, he knows, and they, you know, Loeffler and all of them know that Andre Ward would be a very difficult fight, and if they can get him to drain down a bit, then it's an advantage for them.
I swear, I remember.
That's exactly right. I mean, I personally think, you know, Canelo's using that 155 as sort of a starting point. In other words, assuming that Golovkin wants 160 and Canelo wants 155, it'll be, yeah, 157, 157 and a half. They'll come in. They'll compromise. They'll meet somewhere in the middle. And, you know, I mean, you're right. It's the only advantage he can get in the fight. And he's going to take it because he knows he can. And he's been on the other side of it before, and he's probably resentful about that. And he's just going to try to secure that advantage because, you know, I mean, if he offers it at 157, if he offers it at 158, no group of Mexicans is going to fault him for that. They're going to instead say, well, Canelo made a genuine effort to make this fight, and you know, and it's Golovkin that's being a bitch. I think if he insists upon the 155, though, I think that'll be bad for him from a public relations standpoint. I don't think that the Mexicans will respect that if they try to get him down all the way almost to the super welterweight limit.
Take this for, you know,
when Floyd demanded Canelo come to 147 at first.
Yeah, I mean, the Mexicans are a knowledgeable fan base. They really, I mean, they're really, you know, emotionally and, you know, they're invested into the sport, and they want champions that they can be proud of. And Canelo has, thus far in his career, honored that tradition of the proud Mexican champion who will take on the challenges. He may not always win all the fights, but he'll take the fights. And he has that going for him. And I think that if he gives Golovkin a 158 catchweight and he puts up a good account of himself, even if he loses, they'll still stick with him. They'll still stay with him. And there's more fights for him, you know, in and around that weight. But I think that if he tries to drain him down to 155, the fans won't respect that. And I think that he's still so young. He's still, what is he, only 24?
25.
But he's still so young that he kind of still has that idealistic streak about him, like he wants to be, you know, a champion, and he wants to do things the right way. It's only later in life. Like, Cotto was kind of that way, too, when he was young, and he took on a lot of the challenges. But then as he got older,
he lost his soul.
As most of us do, they get jaded, they get cynical, and they start being all about the money. And, of course, you know, when you have a family and everything, it becomes about, you know, I have mouths to feed, I have people to provide for. But he's still young. He still is, thinking about his legacy seen everything. He hasn't crossed over yet to be about the money. And you know, that's nice to see. And you kind of want to see people who have that streak. You want to see them do well because, you know, that's how we wish all fighters would be.
Can I just say something quick, right? I've just had a quick look online, and the highest weight that they're both rehydrated is 171 pounds, so they're roughly about the same size. Well, that's on the HBO scales.
I mean, Canelo didn't reweigh last night.
Well, I never seen it for last night, but I know against Trout it was 171. But here's another interesting point. When Josh Colotti weighed in against Manny Pacquiao, at welterweight, he weighed 170 pounds. I know Victor Ortiz has weighed in a lot at welterweight in the high 160s. Another thing is, Gennady Golovkin has said that he would meet Floyd Mayweather at light middleweight, 154 pounds. He'd have no problem meeting that weight, so I really didn't have a problem with this catchweight at all.
More money off
again, higher risk, better, you know, risk and reward is much, you know, far different for the Canelo fight and the Floyd fight. You know, the boy lost those extra pounds to make that fight for the millions and millions of difference and the audience that you'd get fighting Floyd.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, people would do anything for a Floyd fight, obviously.
Exactly.
I mean, people would, they'll make outlandish boasts that they probably can't even really back up.
I've been hearing this on Twitter all day, people defending him and saying that Canelo's going to pull some bullshit move, but at the end of the day, the guy's trying to get somebody else at a catchweight who's fucking huge, should be a light heavyweight, and he says he'd make 154, so these are the words coming to his mouth. I don't really see how anybody can depend on him.
If they say they can make the weight, and they make the weight, then it's a fair fight, period. Yep.
Correct.
And that's all it is. And what I would say, though, also, is just that... I think that he would actually benefit personally from coming in a little bit heavier. I think what he knows is that he cuts weight better than other fighters.
You can't get away with it for that long, though, Donnie. Not at that age. I mean, that age you can do it, but not as you get older.
Right, that's what I'm saying, but he knows he's younger.
And he's been in with Golovkin in the gym, in the sparring session. He knows he's getting his shit put his
shit. And you know, the funny thing is, though, is that if you've ever looked at that photo of them in the sparring session, they look exactly the same size.
Yeah, I know it's a couple years ago.
But they look like they're perfectly matched for one another.
Yeah.
They look like, you know, I mean, there shouldn't be...
Except for the scales.
Yeah, but there shouldn't be that much bit about it. And you know, the original account I heard of it was from, like, I don't remember the original source, but I heard Dougie Fish's account. You know, he's been a visitor to this podcast as well, and he says that it was a pretty even sparring session.
I heard that as well, but
yeah. And so I mean, you know what? I think a lot of people are counting Canelo out, and I think that that's inappropriate. I don't think that's right. I think that. I know the sparring session was like 2 years ago or whatever, but still, if you take any stock from that at all, this was one of the most heavily attended, in terms of journalists, sparring session ever, because people were so excited about the future prospects of Canelo and the future prospects of Golovkin. And, I mean, it was like everybody like all converged on this one spot in the California mountains to see... you know, this sparring session between two people, and because at that particular time also, you have to understand there was the Golden Boy and Top Rank divide and all that kind of stuff, and so no one ever thought it was going to be possible for these two guys to meet in the ring, and so they thought, well, this might be the only chance to ever see how they measure up against each other. Let's see what they got, and everybody went there, and you know, there are accounts that differ, but I mean, I would say most accounts say that it was a pretty even fight, and I think that mythology that surrounds the sparring session, I think, would make for a very, very marketable fight. I can't wait for it. I think Canelo will take it. I think they'll meet somewhere in the middle, and that's the way it is.
I think Golovkin took it easy on him because then they want to fuck up a big payday doing something on the line on him. Yeah,
that's possible.
Right, let's say we've won a bit now.
Andy. Andy.
Quickly.
Sorry. Couple of points. It was a big win for Golden Boy last night after they've already lost one challenger to Lemieux. I know Canelo's in a different league than Lemieux. But the second point, Steve Kim tweeted last night, they're the scorecards you get when you don't pay your WBC fees.
I suppose that's fair enough, aye. So, listeners, knows we'll have Bryn Jonathan Butler coming on in about half hour's time to discuss the Regal fight. Also, he's going to be discussing some news regards to Roy Jones Jr. He's spent some 5 days with, and I believe our very own Donnie Baseball, which we're having a quick chat with him also about some comments in the previous interview.
Go on, Donnie.
Moving on, though, if anybody's seen Ronnie Rios against Jason Velez, dive in with that one, guys. But Takahashi Maura against Francisco Vargas.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. I agree it's potentially fight of the year, guys. I don't know what user opinions are on it, but I had one fella tweet me actually today. He's a big fan of Francisco Vargas. Looked a wee bit at him, actually. I'll get his name in a minute if I can find him here on the... shit, give me a second here to try and find him. Nah, I'm not finding him anymore. But anyways, it was a really good fight. I did think, you know, Maura was winning that fight until basically the game changing punch in the right head.
Tony Lance jumped the gun a little bit.
What?
Yeah. It was right when Miros was just starting to punch back. It was just like it was the middle of an exchange almost, and he stopped it. Let him, when it's a fight that good, you want to see it get to a final conclusion.
Nah, I mean I can't say. I mean, we gave Paul Adam shit last week for that stoppage of Dodd against Cardo. I think that stoppage was bang on. I mean, he could have easily waved it off, which I'd have been pissed off with. Because as I said last week, you give the champion that much respect. If he gets up on his feet, you give him the 8-count minimum, get him to walk towards you. He did that. He did the right thing. The fighter walked toward him. He gave him every chance to throw back. He didn't take it. And I think the stoppage was fair.
He was throwing back.
Eh? My view on that was, I thought Miura's chin was almost too good for his own good, because in the first round he took that massive bomb, managed to stay on his feet, and then, you know, survived. But when the finish came, he took another massive bomb, stayed on his feet. I think you said that you actually thought he touched down. And
yeah, he touched down. Look at it. It was his left hand. He bounced back up and he took I think it was a left hook right hand combination he took.
Yeah. And that was So it was his chin and his will to stay upright, even though he did slightly touch down, was almost too strong and too good for his own good.
Yeah, he should have took a knee, shouldn't he?
Yeah, I mean, Alex, we said that last week, mate. I mean, he's not the most technical fighter, but he's one tough, hard motherfucker. And as Adam probably says, probably quite rightly, that maybe he was just a wee bit too tough for his own good there. But I want to see a rematch.
Yeah, rematch is a good shout. For me, that is fight of the year so far. I mean, you know, we've said it before, it's been a bit of a dire year, really, and, you know, I suppose that does a bit of discredit to this fight, but I thought it was an excellent little fight. It had, you know, all the ebb and flow and all the drama that you expect from a fight of the year candidate. You know, it had knockdowns, it had a guy almost getting stopped in the first round, and, you know, well, almost, should we say, but he comes battling back, and, you know, opens up this massive, you know, horrible cut on Vargas's eye. I think that was really probably the thing that helped him, you know, get back into the fight. I think that Vargas was just landing the right hands at will for a long while at the start of the fight, and I thought that Miura was in deep shit there. But as soon as he got that cut opening up, he was getting his own left hands, you know, just purely because Vargas couldn't see them. And then, you know, Vargas almost getting stopped the round before the actual stoppage. You know, if that round lasted another 5 seconds, I reckon the ref would have jumped in there himself. I mean, it was just an absolutely fantastic fight, I think. You know, like you say, Miura, he comes forward a bit too much, he uses his head a bit too much, his defence, but some of us quite like that sort of style, I think. And, you know, a very entertaining fight. And I saw Asian Boxing tweet that Miura said he wanted the rematch. And, you know, whether or not Vargas will be up for it is another question, because, you know, I think that maybe not lucky, but he certainly pulled out of the bag there, because he was on the way to, you know, getting his ass beat.
It was Ian Townsend. I was just asked one of the Twitter questions, actually. He says, how much did the panel think Vargas can achieve? Been a fan for a while, exciting and skilled, bit of a Mikey Garcia about him. And I just basically was asking quite some questions and stuff like that. He said he could clean up at 130, wait for some of the 126 pounders to come up, perhaps. Didn't look like he could go up. He doesn't think he could go up very high in weight. Vargas doesn't think he's. He caught my eye on the Canelo undercard. Loved his shootout with Wama. Past that, I know, but he can box if need be. So I reckon he gambled on KO and Maura. And I suppose you could probably say that actually, because he had to do something to change the tide of that fight. I did think that Maura was basically starting to kind of maybe begin to start pulling away in the cards, maybe. I don't know what you guys think. I maybe had maybe two or three points to Maurer in front at that point.
Well, he had all the momentum, didn't he? Like I said, he nearly stopped him, and he was just constantly pushing forward, and he got that big punch and just clocked him.
I like him, Andy. I like the look of Vargas, I must say. I picked him to win, but it was because I didn't really know. I hadn't really watched a lot of Miura, or whatever you call him. I think Vargas would take the rematch. He strikes me as that type of guy, and I think he can do well. He has his deficiencies, and he was struggling in there at times, but seems to have spirit, power. Definitely like the look of that guy. I want to see more of him.
The other thing is he's got heart about him, because there's been a lot. I mean, that eye was starting to swell up really bad. A bad cut below it as well, and he kept fighting through it. I think they maybe you just don't know. I mean, I'm not going to say if buts or maybes, but you just don't know if that fight just kept going and Maurer kept landing those left hands. He can maybe have forced a stoppage with the eye damage and stuff, but no, he came out there and did it.
It's possible. Ifs and buts, though, isn't it? Like, and I thought the stoppage was fair enough. I mean, I can see where Dave was coming from, because at first I thought to myself it was maybe a bit premature because I was only keeping half an eye at that point, but watching it back, and I don't think he was thrown back. I thought he took two or three real hard shots and he was sort of swaying to the side, and I think Dave's got a bit of Grim Reaper going on there. I think poor Almeida would have been stretched on out there.
I mean, I think if there's a rematch, Vargas might actually do him in about four or five rounds.
He was pretty much destroying him the first couple of rounds last night, wasn't he? Until basically that eye came up in the fourth round knockdown. And then, that really hampered him, I think.
Kurt, fight of the year for you, mate?
Well, after watching Rigondeaux this morning, I mean, I think anything would have been fight of the year. But no, those two guys, that's what you want to see. I mean, they put it all on the line. I mean, like everyone said, I mean, Vargas started brilliantly. He just had the faster hands, and he was just getting to Miura before Miura could really get off, and no head movement from Miura, and everything was just landing. And to be fair to him, I mean, he come back, and then once he hurt him with the left hand and dropped him in, the fourth round, I thought the tide had turned. I thought Miura was starting to walk through him and started to really hurt him. And then out of nowhere, that's that big shot. And I think the ref did what we talked about. You know, he could have stopped it then, because Miura was all over the place. I mean, he had his arms raised in the air. I don't think he knew where he was. But the ref, you know, gave him a chance. And, you know, seeing Miura hurt earlier in the fight, he probably thought, well, you know, let's give him that opportunity to do it again. And he was holding on for a bit. And, you know, he wasn't really firing back or foul. And he was just taking big punches. And I think the stoppage was right, because the man was obviously hurt, but the ref did what we want refs to do. I mean, just give the guy a chance, you know, even if it's only 10 seconds, just let's see what he can do. Let's see if he can hold his way through the round or something. And, you know, Miura couldn't, but two guys who put absolutely everything on the line and a rematch, yeah, why not? I mean, we'd all want to see that again.
Tommy, Marcus Bellinger was asking a question today. Who would prevail in a Super 6, Super Featherweight, Super style type tournament with Lomachenko, Gamboa, Maurer, Vargas, Walters, and Yuji Yama?
Lee Shelby.
Yeah, taking Shelby up for that.
Well, nah, I'd go for Lomachenko, obviously, man. I think he's fucking quality.
Even with Gamboa coming down in weight?
Aye, I think maybe that fight with Crawford's maybe just taking a wee bit out of him. He's maybe just lost the wee edge, but I can't see him pass Lomachenko. I'm a massive fan of him. I think he's improved all the time he's a pro. I wasn't actually too convinced of him how he was going to be a great pro after watching the Salido fight. I know Salido was huge, but he just used to be coming on. He's looked like he's turning a really good pro. He's fucking... He'd win that, yeah.
Right, Dave, did you catch Rios against Velez, or did anybody catch his fight?
I just saw Vélez lost, and it's about time, because I never thought that guy was very good. I thought Gradovich beat him.
Tommy, he was a mate of yours, was he not?
I like Vélez. I hung out with him a wee bit, hung his trainer when I was over at Trout and Cotto. Nice guys. He's not got much English here, but I just didn't think the guy turned up last night. That's an understatement here, but fucking hell.
I was laughing when you said he's not got much English.
He's got fucking zero English.
Not for his tummy.
That's what I was
But he's fucking, he never turned up last night, did he?
No.
Did he get some of Tommy's dietary and drinking habits, and that's what's just messed him up now since that meeting?
He's just not that good, is he, considering the record? I mean, statistically, he looks impressive, but I mean, Jesus, no thanks.
I was quite impressed. I was impressed with him against the young Sanchez, man. He fucking blew him away, didn't he? Well, he's not a great fighter, Sanchez, but But no, nobody blows him away. And, I thought he got a draw against Gradovic, yeah.
Right, so say we'll leave the Rigondeaux card fight until we get Brin on the line, so we'll just jump on at the Sky card. main event, Anthony Crawler picks up the Panamanian lightweight title against, well, a fifth round stoppage against Dallas Perez, Adam. Crawler, I mean, people are shitting on Perez and stuff like that, he's the worst world champion, this, that, and the next thing, stuff. Okay, people might have a point, but I've got to say, well done Crawler last night. I mean, one of the nicest guys in the sport. I met him just before he schooled Willie Lemon, actually, a couple of years back for the British title in Motherwell. But, really pleased for him. I thought he was razor sharp last night, on point. Every punch he threw, it was crisp, it was clear, it was sharp. I don't think you were too convinced with the stoppage. I know you're going to say Perez quit. I just think, you know, if you take a body shot like that, especially with full torque turned into it, Perez knew instantly he was fucked. And I don't think it was a quick job.
I just think he
couldn't get up.
I've not watched the replay. Well, obviously, I watched the replay on TV last night, but you guys advised me to watch the replay today, having made my intention to call it a quit. No, I wasn't impressed by Perez. I've not been impressed by him in the 17 rounds that we've seen him on British soil. He's not been anywhere near good enough, and that's probably why he's aligned himself with the Panamanian boys. You know, I just thought that all Crawler needed last night was a repeat of July, and obviously he's bettered that. I was surprised in the shot because at the time Perez was on the ropes. I think he was just throwing a left hook of his own, but he went down and he didn't get up, obviously. And I thought, I just wasn't impressed with it, to be honest. And I've seen, at that level, I think you should be getting up from shots like that. I think it was on the button. Crawler is not known as a big puncher. I'll have to go back and watch the replay, but it was in close quarters. I didn't think, you know, he was loading up. I don't think it was he was loading up a la Golovkin against Macklin, where that was loaded up, you know, full torque, you know, full swing. I thought this was, you know, just a close quarters, you know, tap to the body. But obviously it landed perfectly and he didn't get up. And I do know they can take your breath away. I've took a couple in my time, but I'm not claiming to be anything special. But, yeah, we're happy for Crawler. I'm just imagining the lengths that Matchroom are going to go to keep that belt hostage. I mean, the lengths already started on Friday with the old WBA. I'm going to get banned, aren't I? With the old announcement of the interim and all that rubbish, with all that rubbish with Mitchell. So the hostage situation of that belt by Matchroom has already started. I am happy for Crawler. He's come a long way. I remember being there when Derry Matthews knocked him out a few years ago in Sheffield. You know, so he's obviously come a long way. He's got well-documented backstory as well. I think the end game of it for Matchroom is to just hand it over to Luke Campbell at some point, but they'll keep it hostage for at least a year, I imagine.
I think we should give Mr. Joe Gallagher or some
kind of... No, it's Master Sensei. Master Sensei.
I'm only joking anyway. Fuck that, man. You're fucking
Master Sensei. Well, Tommy, listen, is it too cruel to say that, you know, even off that performance here last night, that is Crawler world class, elite level?
Nah, no chance. He's no world class or elite level. I think Luke Campbell is probably the best lightweight in the country just now. And I think Ricky Burns is the second best.
Better than Flanagan. Because I think we all said that Flanagan was the number one just a couple of weeks back. Now we're saying Crawler. I would need to say Flanagan's still number one.
Nah, well, if I'm looking at judging him by resume or that, I think like through talent, who would win and against head to head and all that. I think Luke Campbell's the best. I think Ricky Burns is the second best. I think Flanagan's the third best. Crawler or Mitchell, you flip a coin there. Eh? That's what I think. He's not a world class or elite fighter. He's done well to get the world title. Nice guy, as I see him. I met him with you, Andy, and I've met him a couple of other events as well. I sat in the pub with him fucking here in New York as well, man. He's Crawler's cool as fuck. A really nice guy, man. I'm glad he won the fight, but no world class or elite for me. No chance.
Alex, Kurt, Steve, now I've got a wee task for you. Without looking at Box Rec, right, how many rounds did you think Perez won last night?
What, officially?
Mm-hmm.
I had it... I can't remember how I was scoring it at the time.
One.
I'll give him two rounds.
I'll give him one.
One.
I'll give him one.
One of the judges actually had it 39-37 for Crawl at one point, and it was 38-38, 38-38 on the other two scorecards.
I gave the fucking the Columbia in the first two rounds and Crawl the next two.
Yeah, I think it was quite even up to the stoppage. I mean, neither guy was really doing much, were they? It was a bit like the first fight. I mean, I didn't really enjoy the first fight. I thought it was a bit boring. And, you know, I was barely paying attention to the rematch. And from what I saw, it just seemed to be more of the same until Crawler landed that, you know, beautiful little body shot.
Alex, I know you would be happy for Crawler last night, mate, knowing you. But to be honest, mate, no, I know you were happy at it. But I just wondering the fact is, you know, if you were actually thinking about hanging yourself, because that's Master Sensei now got another notch on the fucking feather.
That's possibly his first time he's beat a proper champion, I think. I mean, wait a minute, what was Quigg? Quigg was fucking sent in the fucking post. Liam Smith, vacant title against fucking Roaster. And Crawler beats Perez, you know, fair play to Crawler. You know, no, I never would have expected Anthony Crawler to become a world champion or hold any sort of title, even a Panamanian title, but fair play to him, he did it, and to Gallagher's credit, or Tesco Joe's credit, you know, I think that he has adapted Crawler quite well, and he has improved him. You know, he's improved leaps and bounds, I think. I thought that Crawler was always a bit too crude and a bit one-dimensional, but he seems a bit, he's vastly improved, I think. And, you know, Perez wasn't up to much, he's a bit shit, but Crawler certainly improved, and you know he deserves it. But I do think Flanagan, Linares, the other belt was very vacant at the moment. Shafikov and Bartholomew are fighting for that. I think that both of them probably beat Crawler, but you know, let him enjoy it while he can.
So Alex, you see, regarding Gallagher, would most of your problem be, or all of your problem be, with his personality and the way he comes across, rather than necessarily his coaching ability or what he does with his fighters, you know, technically and such?
Stadium fight.
I think he's vastly overrated for what he's actually achieved. I think he is improving some of his fighters. I think that, you know, that's plain to see. I think he's improved Quigg. I think he's improved Crawler. He's definitely gone backwards with Cardle. You know, you turn Cardle in from a, you know, technical boxer into a fucking spastic little zoomer who goes and loses and gets schooled by fucking Masha Dodd. Well, not loses, but you know what I mean. You know, and I think obviously his ego is just completely out of control, and he makes it about himself. And, you know, the saying, the Joe Gallagher show, is always relevant. He always seems to want to make it about himself, and I think, you know, according to reports of many, many other trainers and people that work with him, he's an absolute cunt.
Whether it's down to Joe or not, I think Crawler is a better boxer sometimes than he gets credit for. I know he trades a lot on heart, and people always seem to mention his resilience and fitness and all these type of things. But I think he is a decent enough boxer. He knows what he's doing in there. He was a very good amateur, and he didn't get the breaks early on in his career for whatever reason. But I think the technical ability is there. He is more technically proficient than people give him credit for, and the way he manoeuvred Perez around and dropped the little body shot in there, I thought was very impressive. Now, having said that, I agree with Kurt or Adam, I can't remember who said it, I haven't been that impressed with Perez at all during these two fights, and I think the fact that these two are fighting for anything resembling a world title says more about the situation with world titles than any of their world-class abilities, in all fairness, and saying that I am pleased for Crawler. But, I mean, come on, is that really world-class as would have been counted, say, 15, 20 years ago? It's extremely questionable. But Perez, as for the body shot, I think the body shot's fair enough. I wouldn't... I mean, I've only asked about it in the gym and stuff, and taking those body shots wouldn't be any fun, I don't think. Look at Golovkin, Macklin, Hopkins, Oscar... If you take one there, only the very best. I mean, look at Daniel Gill against Darren Barker. How on earth Barker got...
Look at Darren Barker.
who did Andy say?
But look at Ali, man. Look at the fucking body punch.
Look, forget about Ali. Right, look at Darren Barker when he was fighting Daniel Gill. How on earth he got it from the body shot? I do not know.
What about Madonna against Khan? That was fucking unbelievable.
That took 3-4 rounds for Chino to go over that, actually. Kurt, I'll let you have the final word on this one, mate. I mean, you've got to give some sort of credit to Master Sensei. I mean, he did tell Crawler, listen, fake the left hook upstairs and come back with it to the body. He did that. If you go back and look at the stoppage, he did that. So fair play to both. Crawler's off for following the instructions to a T.
Yeah, I mean, we all say what you want about Joe Gallagher, but the guy has improved under his tutelage, and so has, I think, the other guys. But my problem is, I'm delighted for Anthony Crawley, realising, since he was a kid, he wanted to be a world champion, and technically he's a world champion, but just like Liam Smith, he's a world champion. But it just annoys me that to be a world champion, they're beating guys who are just absolutely rubbish. Darlis Perez, forget his record, the guy is absolutely useless. The guy who Liam Smith fought, useless. And yet someone like Tyson Fury next week has to face someone like Klitschko to be a world
that's
champion.
That's a good point, man.
That's what annoys me. Even someone like Matthew Macklin, he had to face Gennady Golovkin, Sergio Martinez. He never won a world title. It all comes down to what division you're in and who are the scrubs who are holding supposed world titles. I mean, that Darlis Perez was absolutely... he's rubbish. I mean, and the fact is, it just speaks about the Panamanians more than anything else. I mean, so full credit to Crawler. He did a great job on the guy. But as Tommy said, he doesn't even... where does he have him ranked? Fifth best or maybe fourth best? I'm not even sure Anthony Crawler would beat Kevin Mitchell. And I think you're Kevin Mitchell, you do everything to make that fight, because Kevin Mitchell, like Crawler, has wanted to be a world champion since he was a kid. And that's going to be his best ever opportunity. And it's just... this guy has won a world title, and we're saying he's not world class, he's nowhere near it. That's what's wrong with boxing, in my opinion.
If Mitchell can come back in the forum he was in before Linares, he'd beat Crawler. I'm just not sure he can be that fighter again after that fight.
But you even look at Mitchell, look at the guy he had to fight, a really good boxer in Linares to be a world champion. Yeah. And he put up a good effort. The fight was pretty close. If he'd be sitting there thinking, fucking hell, I wish I got Darlis Perez, And same as the other guys who Liam Smith fought. God, I wish I was fucking fighting that, whoever he was.
I agree with you. I agree with you wholeheartedly, but I know he's moved up now, but just imagine the likes of Terence Crawford against Crawler and Mitchell. It would
Massacre, man. Fuck's sake, a massacre.
Even Broner down there. Broner was a fucking shit hot lightweight, man. He was fucking... they're all sorts of damage down there. Okay, what I'm just going to say about Joe Gallagher, imagine that Paul Smith was decent and they managed to get him a world title somehow.
Because I know,
but I'll tell you something. I think Stephen Smith will win a world title. Callum Smith will win a world title. And Liam's already got one. And see if Paul won one, he'd be fucking screaming for a knighthood, wouldn't he? With fucking four brothers with world titles, man. He's wanting them on Quest. He's wanting them on fucking the BBC.
Personality,
because I've won British titles. Imagine they won world titles. Fuck me.
Kurt summed it up perfectly there, though, didn't he? I think what Adam said about Crawford sums it up exactly there. If Terence Crawford was there, then yeah, Crawler is reached the level that he probably should have reached, but the fact that he's called himself a world champion and someone else who has to go through all these roadblocks can't is exactly, sums it up in a nutshell, really.
Yeah,
lightweight's done a kind of stopover division, has it? Hasn't it?
Yeah, somehow.
It's a combination of things, isn't it? There's a lot of hard work and hard preparation, but a lot of the times you need a lot of fucking good luck as well.
Good matchmaking by Master Ascendancy, as usual.
Yeah.
I think Crawler would beat Mitchell. I've only seen the guy fight like 2-3 times, but every time I've seen him, he's surprised me and, most importantly, people who actually know who he is and predict that he's going to lose. Because he's upset a lot of guys in fashions like knockouts that people wouldn't expect, and I think he looked really good yesterday. I always thought he was a guy who just sort of moved around, stuck to the jab for the most part, tried to get the hour shot in, but he was on the inside. He had great head movement, worked the body excellently. I think he's definitely pushing even the world class definition. I think he has a chance to be there. I think he's the perfect example of a guy who started out rough because he had difficulty adjusting his amateur style to the pro ranks, which are a lot tougher and a lot meaner. And he's finally made that adjustment, and he's really improved thanks to on-the-job training. And perhaps Tesco Joe as well.
Jerky's got more talent than Kevin Mitchell.
More talent, I don't know about that, but Kevin Mitchell's a very good example of a waste of talent.
Yeah, well, I'd agree with that, but I'd say Mitchell's a lot more talented than Crawler.
Mm-hmm.
I think he is. It's just like the difference is like hard work that
But in terms of the titles and, you know, it's just the opportunity. I mean, you think of someone like Harold Graham. I mean, he had to face guys like Mike McCallum, Julian Jackson, and he never won a world title. But if he just had the opportunity to fight absolute mock like some of these guys, he'd have been a definite one. Look at someone like Frank Bruno. I mean, he had to fight Lennox Lewis and Mike Tyson in his world title attempts. It's just the luck of the draw, really. In today, with so many world titles and so many bullshit bouts, I mean, Enzo Macronelli next month, he's fighting for a supposed world title. You know what I mean? It's just absolute nonsense. But as much as they are nice guys, you just because someone's a nice guy, we can't backtrack on everything we've said before just because someone's a nice guy. We all wish Cryla the best. We all are delighted that he won. But he's not a real world champion, in my opinion. He beat a guy who shouldn't even be holding a world title himself, but it's just the luck of the draw. And I say, you know, he done a job on him, so fair play, but let's hope he can get some decent fighters and let's see what he can do against someone of note.
Spot on.
Well, according to our podcast, though, he's not a real world champion, though, because it's Panamanian, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, nothing involving the Panamanian is real.
Right, I'm going to give Adam the chance to recap Nurse against Jenkins very briefly, and before we do, Steve, give me your take on Ryan Burnett's performance last night against Jason Booth.
Ryan Burnett, talented guy, excellent amateur. Adam Booth's comments before the fight have not done him any favours, talking about world top 10, etc. He's only a young guy, 23 years of age, a lot of pressure on his shoulders, and I think his talent is there physically, but he's not dealing with the mental pressure very well at the moment. And yeah, he didn't perform after about the fourth round. I think he got old manned by Jason Booth, and the commentators weren't happy, the fans weren't happy, the Twitter weren't happy. And I just hope that Burnett can bounce back, because, you know, it seems like Tabakiri might take that to heart, but he's definitely talented, and it's not the end of the road for him by any stretch of the imagination. But Booth's comments, I think, put a lot of pressure on him that was unnecessary.
Absolutely agree, Steve, with the Booth comments. But, I mean, from a Ryan Burnett point of view, I know you've listed a lot of people there that won't be happy. I think Adam Booth and Ryan Burnett might be actually quite happy. You know, they've got 12 rounds against a seasoned veteran. But, I mean, obviously, we're all in agreement that it was extremely boring, and, you know, Burnett should have been finishing him. I think there's Jason Booth. I mean, he's 38, hasn't fought in so many months, and has lost 7 of his last 8 or something along them lines. I mean, he should have been sorting him out, but moving on to Nurse and Jenkins, I mean, them two lads, they need to do it again. They're just two styles that blend really well. You're going to see blood, you're going to see stiffened legs, you're going to see, you know, styles that look good in one round and look crap in the other. I mean, Nurse in one round will look like, you know, the Huddersfield's answer to Floyd Mayweather, and then in the next round he looks like a fool when Andre Berto tried the shoulder roll, you know. It was fun, though. It was quite fun. I think Nurse deserved it. Jenkins just ain't that good, in all honesty. I know Nurse is hard to catch, but I'm glad he won, because there's quite a few fighters out there at whatever they want to call that weight nowadays, £140, I'll call it. There's quite a few fights out there for Nurse and Jenkins. If they do it again, maybe, or there's Ryan, whatever his name is, who lost to Good John last time. So there's a few fights out there. Look forward to seeing them, to be honest. They're good 8 o'clock starters. They're the perfect ones we want. We don't want to see Cal Yafai against some Mexican road sweep, but we want to see two blokes in a 50-50 fight going for the British title. And I know the commentators said it last night, and we don't often agree with them, but that British title, it does bring good performances out in people. They're the fights we want to see. More of that, please.
Yeah, of course it does. Obviously, we've been saying this for ages. I mean, I was at a show on Friday night in Belfast. These two guys, undefeated guys, 7-0 and 11-0, one from Belfast, one from just outside of Belfast, fighting for the Celtic middleweight title. Brilliant fight. That's all you want. These people who are coming over for these baubles, they're not interested. Stick two guys with a grudge, or domestic guys who are hungry, with a decent title on the line. Bang, there you go.
Right. Bryn's on the line, but before we do get him to chat, just very briefly cover the last fight. Arthur Abraham against Martin Murray. Split decision victory for Arthur Abraham, 116, 111, 115, 112, and for Abraham, sorry, 115, 112 for Martin Murray. Now, a question brought up, I'm trying to think now who was it asked, that the question was, has there been anybody who has had more world titled, who was it, Jake? What is the most amount of times a fighter has challenged for a world title before winning one? Now, Matt, I remember this one from a while, but I'm pretty sure the answer is Jersey Joe Walcott. Five times it took him to win the World Heavyweight title. Anybody can correct me on that. I think Yaki Lopez, Alex, who you mentioned, yeah, maybe is another
one. He had five, but he never won, did he?
Never won one.
Rocky
hugely
Juarez
different eras, though, like, I mean, as we discussed earlier, isn't it?
What's that, mate?
I think hugely different eras, as we discussed earlier as well, plays a part in that. I mean, Frig May, Jersey Joe Walcott wasn't fighting against road sweepers. I'm not saying Murray is either, to be fair, but, I mean, it's a hell of a lot easier to sort of push your way into a shot these days.
Well, we did see
I was disappointed in Murray last night, in all honesty.
Well, I don't know what else you expect from Martin Murray. Martin Murray does what Martin Murray does. You know, he doesn't let his hands go more enough. He doesn't put the pressure on as much. He did at one point, I think after the point going to TD, he went in kind of heavy. But, you know, I don't know what else you expect this guy to do. I mean, some people say Sergio Martinez beat off him. I think Abraham was very lucky in some regard, but I did have him winning the fight by a point. The point deduction really did help him. It gave him that wee extra boost of confidence, I think. And I just think, again, I think the way Murray actually approaches the fight sometimes, you know, if he started a lot quicker in times with some of those early rounds in the bank, he could definitely have won it. But
to me, it's like, you know, when a fighter's in, like, sparring mode, you know, when he's been a sparring partner a long time and he's getting that, when he doesn't do enough to win a fight, or they presume he doesn't have that in him to win a fight. That's what I see with Martin Murray. He likes... It's like he goes in a fight knowing he'll come out of it having the brave and heroic effort, but just falling short. And it's like he's content with that, and he hasn't got that extra in him just to push, because that fight there was there for him. I mean, we saw Paul Smith gave a real go against Abraham. Abraham is, you know, he was a once feared guy at middleweight, but those days are long gone. He's at a weight where really he's quite small, and he's well past his best. He's still picking up some decent efforts, but all you need is work rate and a bit of speed, and you'll beat Arthur Abraham, but he just didn't have it in him to really push for it, and to me that's his last chance now. He needs to go back and pick up some, let's see him actually win against a good name, because can anyone tell me his best win? Because I like Martin Murray, but he hasn't really got a good win on his record.
Adam, you're on mute, mate.
He just didn't do enough. He rocked him bad in the 8-4-9. And I'm screaming at the TV, follow it up, put the pressure on him. And when you put the pressure on Abraham, and when you don't let him fight at the pace he wants to fight at, that's your best chance. But all night long, Murray was just giving up the centre of the ring far too easily. He wasn't capitalising, he wasn't throwing enough punches. It was almost as if he didn't trust his stamina. And a man with that experience should know his stamina and should trust his stamina. If you can't win last night, you might as well pack up. And I know that Eddie's already said, you know, he's dismissed it, I shouldn't pack up. We've got, you know, he's got all sorts of fights there. Yeah, but he's going to be a sacrificial fighter to, you know, to the likes of Callum Smith or George Groves. He's already started flirting with Groves. I mean, just not good enough from Martin Murray last night. I was disappointed. I did think he would win, but he didn't. And, I think that's it now. I don't think he even deserves another world title fight after that.
I thought McKech sent in a good question there earlier on there. He says, was round 7 last night the most footwork Arthur Abraham has exhibited in the last 5 years? I think that's when he got tripped up or something like that, and he had this wee kind of shimmy. Was that the round he was hurt in? I can't remember which one it was.
He actually got hurt by Martin Murray.
he got I wouldn't say hurt, but he certainly got wobbled. Well, I'll say he got hurt because he got wobbled a little bit, and he looked to kind of move about, and then He grabbed onto the ropes for a little bit as well, so I think he was definitely hurt.
Sounds like this fight was a lot more worthy of a rematch than the first Paul Smith fight, then.
I think the problem with the Paul Smith fight is going into that fight, nobody gave Smith an absolute chance and said he'd be knocked out early, he shouldn't be there, he's different levels. So he was semi-competitive, so it's automatically a close fight or a robbery, whereas this fight, everyone knew that Abraham probably would nick it, but it would be close.
Yeah. Okay. Brad, you there, mate? Brad? Can't hear him. He popped away.
Just on Murray, there's a Value of the Week nomination for his manager because he was celebrating like he just won the FA Cup final. I forgot his manager's name. He's normally a nice, approachable fellow, Martin Murray's manager, but he's getting a Value of the Week nomination.
Not Steve Wood, is he?
No, it's a local lad to St. Helens. He's always been with Murray. I forgot his name, sorry.
Murray did okay, didn't he? The thing that annoyed me, though, was the Sky commentary, and I took to Twitter to air my frustrations at this, because they seemed to think that Abraham was winning all the way through, and at the end, they had Abraham winning on their scorecards, and then as soon as it was announced that he'd lost, they start all this, oh, what does Martin Murray have to do to get a decision?
Yeah.
You know, well, I mean, you pair had him losing, so, I mean, that'd be a good start if you actually thought he won the
exactly.
fight and the judges.
It's like he should get the decision. He should get the WBO belt because they think he should have beat Sergio Martinez. It's like, well, what does that matter now? Did he do enough to win? In your eyes, he didn't do enough to win, so what are you complaining about?
And Sky needs some hammer as well last night. There was two people on the three-person... The three-person panel last night was a wonderful concentration of idiots in one place. But we'll go past that, and I include Carl Froch on that.
I thought Carl Froch was bang on you last night. He says that he didn't think Murray had done enough to win the fight, and that's what Paul Smith said as well.
Yeah, I agree. What we've missed out on is Ryan Burnett pissing about with a 38-year-old for 36 minutes, but there's two people standing ringside that between them have had three fights with Arthur Abraham and have not been able to comment on the fight before it happened.
Yeah.
That's bad planning, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, I think,
Froch was bang on.
Bryn, you there, mate?
I'm here. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we can hear you fine now, mate. It's good to get you on again. First things first, mate, we haven't discussed the fight yet, but I'll let you take a lead on it. Guillermo Rigondo last night. There's a lot of comments saying it was boring to watch. I switched it off after seven rounds. The mismatch was, it was mismatch central for me. I did think it was a lot of rinse and repeat from Rigo. And again, he didn't take any risks against an outclassed opponent, really, who really could really have stopped, no?
Oh, I mean, he landed 72 punches in the fight. I think his opponent landed around 45. That's just not enough action for a pay-per-view undercard on an undercard of Cotto and Canelo. It was pretty disappointing to kind of showcase every cliche that has been levied against him from the likes of Dan Rafael and company. So it was hard to watch.
Yeah, Dan was loving it. I saw him on Twitter at the time, throwing out his old jokes, falling asleep here and similar sort of nonsense. I thought that, I expect that from, trolls and the like, and, I'm prone to trolling myself, but someone like him is, you expect a bit better, but, the fight itself was awful, I thought.
Bryn, just Steve here, Rigondo has become very negative, overly negative. Whenever he knocked out the likes of Willie Casey, he came out, he put it to Casey. I know he was miles levels below him, but he looked impressive. I mean, really, really impressive the way he put his shots together. Why are we not seeing that Rigondo now? I mean, is he really that pissed off? Why is he not putting his feet down and knocking out the likes of Joanne Francisco, which he should have been doing?
He's doing the same against Stephen, what do you call him? Ramos as well, wasn't he? Mm-hmm. Went and stepped in that fight as well.
And Tion Kennedy.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard because going into the Donaire fight, when I was putting together a highlight reel of his fights, there was a knockout in every single fight leading up to Donaire. I mean, now I think he's 16-0 and he has 10 knockouts, but this unwillingness of opponents to throw a punch, I mean, 42 punches in a 10-round fight landed? I mean, it's astounding. But his unwillingness to capitalize against, inferior competition, even for, people like me who are just huge supporters of him, who admire what he's able to do, it's just so frustrating to see this unwillingness and just a complete indifference to sort of what the public is asking for, especially when going into this fight, going into several fights that have been, heavily booed, he promotes them by saying he's going to give something special, he's going to dominate them, he's going to knock people out, and he seems to have every opportunity to do it, and it seems analogous to me, almost as if like Michael Jordan would put a prohibition on dunking a basketball. from now on, I'm just going to lay the ball in, and that should be enough. Well, it's never going to be enough. It's always going to piss people off. And I don't understand it financially. I don't understand it in terms of trying to improve his standing with critics. It's just maybe he just needs the better opponent to sort of bring out the best, but it's just remarkably frustrating to watch.
Here, Brendan, is there anything kicking around as to how much money that Roc Nation are throwing at Regal?
$10 million for 4 years is the figure that I heard.
Damn, and how much of that do you think he needs to pay off to Caribe and all those freebies that he got whilst he came over here? Oh, sorry, came over to America, sorry. Because I dare say he'll have a lot of debt to pay off.
Yeah, I mean, that's what Freddie Roach said to Gary Hyde when Hyde was still actively managing him, is you will never get rid of Miami. It doesn't matter if you keep winning in the law, the courts of law, which Gary Hyde did, you will never get rid of them. And they're still there, even, you know, despite the fact that Jay-Z has now shelled out $10 million to get him back into the ring, get him on HBO. So they're still there. So your guess is as good as mine as to why they are still there. Either they're doing such a brilliant promotional job, or they have some hooks in them. So either way, they're still there.
Okay. Just to run through these some of these Twitter questions while I've got you on, Brendan, and stuff, if you want to hang around. I know Donnie's want to have a quick chat with you about some comments and stuff, but I know you've been spending some time with Roy Jones Jr., mate, for the last 5 days or so. What's the current there? What's been happening?
Yeah, well, he just got his Russian citizenship, and I was fortunate that he wasn't in Russia at the time that I flew over to his... he has an 81-acre property in Pensacola still, where him and his wife and his kids live. So I was just able to sort of hang out with him for 5 or 6 days, meet a lot of his family, including his father, who he hasn't really spoken with in 11 years, and sort of revisit some of the stories that we've always heard about Roy Jones and just get more of his perspective on his career and some interesting hypotheticals about how he thought he would have done against Mike Tyson, who he said he went out of his way to try and secure a fight with after he beat John Ruiz, and also a possible matchup with Floyd Mayweather if they were at around 154 pounds, and it was just very interesting to hear his perspective. He just has such a knowledge of the game, and yet here he is on the brink of being 47 years old, and he's still fighting. He has been fighting competitively for as long as I've been alive, which is 36 years, which kind of boggles the mind. So very interesting experience.
Did you take any of these training camps, Bryn, for the Enzo Macronelli fight by the end of this year? Because we're talking to Big Enzo, hopefully get him on the show before he flies out to Russia. How's his prep going for the fight?
He's doing his best. His age is a big thing. You know, his knees are not great. You know, road work is something that I think he struggles with. He plays a lot of basketball, but I mean, he has the knees of a 75-year-old construction worker who's had a few accidents. So it's pretty amazing to me that he is still trying to function as a professional athlete. He's just tens of thousands of miles.
We're getting feedback off someone there.
I've muted him.
All right. Sorry, mate. Oh, sorry, Brendan, you go, mate.
No, he's just struggling, I think, physically, just in terms of just all the things you'd expect from an athlete who's been going for 36 years. The knees cause a lot of pain, a lot of aches. So instead of doing road work, he was wearing a 50-pound vest, and he would shadow box, and he was training a few fighters on his property. But, I mean, he's still taking it very seriously, and I think he is as obsessed as ever with winning a cruiserweight title down the road. So, that's his whole life. It's hard for me to imagine after spending 5 days with him that he will ever retire from boxing, which is not all that inspiring if you care about him. And he is a really good guy, a very decent person. So, yeah, that was...
Has Dave, Roy, to your knowledge, ever looked into...
Dave,
YouTube's not
back
on.
Off you.
Right now?
Yep. Every time someone speaks to me, get feedback off you. Is it YouTube or something?
No, nothing's on right now. I just wanted to ask a quick question, though. Has Roy, to your knowledge, ever looked into the stem cell method of healing the joints? I mean, which is it's apparently a new thing that the MMA fighters are getting into. Dana White and Joe Rogan were recently talking about it on a podcast, and it's like it can heal the damage to one's knees, make the knees almost like a young athlete's again.
No, he didn't mention anything of that sort. He did have a hyperbaric chamber in one of his homes that I saw that was interesting that I'd never read about. The kind for oxygenating the blood to help with stamina and that kind of thing. But otherwise, he seems like a very old school kind of person when it comes to training. Still claims that he's never lifted weights other than when he tried to fight John Ruiz. So, it was very, very throwback in his methods with training, discipline with diet and regular training in the mornings. So I don't know that he's really altered much of that routine all these years later.
Bryn, Roy's obviously got the Enzo Macronelli fight coming up soon. Does he pay much heed to the opponents these days, or is he just training away and, you know, he knows that he's boxing at such a level now that he hasn't got anything majorly to be concerned about? Does he, you know, does he take much notice of who these guys are? Does he know who they are? I mean...
He seemed very... I mean, I think he takes it seriously. He did mention at various phases of his career, especially when he was dominant, the heyday, that boredom would set in. So he seemed to be particularly excited by this phase of his career where so many people are sort of clamoring for him to leave the sport. And I think that, in his mind, kind of eggs him on to take on even more challenges. He's a very religious person. He's very devoted to the idea that when his life is over, he's going to meet God, and God is going to say, I gave you this much talent. You came to me with only X amount of world championships. You should have won. You should have done what nobody's ever done in the sport and won that cruiserweight title. Some of it just seemed kind of scary because you just think, like, what this guy was able to accomplish in his professional career. I mean, he's been a Hall of Famer since he was 25, 26 years old, you know, routing the likes of Hopkins and James Toney, and it just never seems to be enough for him. So I think he's really hell-bent on going after this cruiserweight championship. He is aware of being selective with opponents. That's not going to put him at as much risk. He mentioned, even when he said, if I won a cruiserweight title, I'd retire, very quickly he was sort of edging into, but maybe one or two back home in Pensacola, just so friends and family can see me. You know, as a chance, so it just doesn't really stop.
I think after everything he's achieved in the sport, I think God will be a pretty harsh critic if he doesn't allow for the fact that he doesn't claim this Panamanian belt.
No, I asked him at one point, this was a bit of a cheeky question, but I meant it respectfully, whether or not God had ever told him to do something that he didn't already want to do in the first place. And he said, you know, with kind of an odd look on his face, no, it's funny, he hasn't. He always seems to want me to do the things that I want to do. So,
yeah, okay.
I guess it's just that kind of internal struggle of, am I humbly following a path, or is hubris the real genesis for it? And I don't think he really struggles to be too introspective about that sort of thing. But as I say, I really liked him. I liked him more every day that I was spending time with him to learn more about him and his family. So it's going to be hard to watch him in the ring the same way. And we've seen him suffer some really hellacious knockouts. I'm thinking Glencoff Johnson. I mean, it took 15 minutes to get him safely out of the ring and into an ambulance. And as somebody
Lebedev was brutal.
Lebedev definitely, yeah.
Oh, Lebedev was so brutal. I talked to his wife about being at the Lebedev fight. If you watch the YouTube of that, you can see her crying in the ring. And I asked her, you know, for all the highs of being with, you know, not just one of the greatest fighters ever, but one of the greatest athletes ever to dominate their sport, are the highs worth the lows? And she just looked at me like I had three heads and just said, you know, of course it's not. Of course, you think watching my husband endure what he did with Lebedev could ever be worth, you know, like whatever he accomplished? It's just so brutal. Everybody's treating it like it's a big party. But it's your husband. It's your, you know, my children are there. So very, very interesting to meet the people behind the life, you know?
Bryn, have you actually seen anything of Enzo Marconelli?
I've seen him in a few articles. I haven't watched his fights personally.
That's a shame. I mean, if one thing, he's got a really good left hook to the body. I know if you say Roy's knees are not going to hold up, then, you know, if he's going to get held on the ropes, Marconelli's quite a big guy. Considerably, well, if anything, he's probably more a light heavyweight, but, you know, he makes cruiserweight nowadays. But, to be honest, Tommy, you would probably agree with me, mate, by saying is if Roy Jones can land that left hook,
Whoever lands the hook first is going to win, aren't they?
Yep.
Enzo's probably is. He's more towards a light heavyweight, but he's probably got heavyweight power, hasn't he? The guy can punch legs.
Yep. Right, okay, what we'll do is I'll bring Donnie in here now. Donnie, mate, I'll let you take it up. I don't know what your problems are or what your issues are, but when the man's here, he's no duck. We're all thinking you were going to duck, but you turned up, so you take it away.
Oh, hey, Bryn, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. I have a little bit of a problem, both just from a, yes, I'm a Tyson fan, but also from just sort of a journalistic standpoint. I used to cover some fights for about a year and a half anyways, but the thing is that I didn't like the way that you basically very strongly implied that Customato was a child molester without any sort of evidence to support that whatsoever. I mean, as far as I know, there's only ever been one piece written on this. It was on the Deadspin website by an author named W.K. Sutton, and he admits that his only source of these allegations is from a well-known Esquire magazine author named Gay Talese.
Yeah.
And that, you know, and that Gay Talese once said to Sutton, the guy that wrote the article, that Floyd Patterson once said that one time when they were sleeping in the same bed, which it's well known that D'Amato had a tremendous fear of gangsters, and at that time Liston had a lot of gangsters around him, and he was worried that his fighter was going to get poisoned and things of that nature. So he, slept in the same bed with him to make sure that no one came in and poisoned him. He said that his foot touched his foot, and, you know, he's like, he wasn't sure if it was basically innocuous and inadvertent or whether it was intentional. But, I mean, that's basically the source of the entire theory. And then you sort of put that together with circumstantial evidence, with the fact that, you know, he left the world of big-time boxing behind in New York, and he opened a camp for fighters in upstate New York, and it was all young boys, and he never married, and he had a room upstairs where he liked to keep all of his, like, boxing stuff, and no one was ever allowed to go up there, and therefore, he's just weird, and he just must be a pedophile. And he
I think that's a pretty gross mischaracterization, and I interviewed both of the people that you mentioned as sources, and you're also omitting the fact that Floyd Patterson himself said on record that he felt Customato had a sexual attraction for him. So it wasn't just an innocuous foot that was touching him from an elderly man sleeping in the same bed with him. It was also somebody that he characterized their relationship with no malice as being sexual in nature.
So what exactly is the source of that? Because I did do my due diligence and I did look for this, but I haven't seen it yet. I mean, if you could tell me where that is.
Well, Kip Sutton, who you're referencing, I interviewed him. I also interviewed Gay Talese, who was an extensive friend of Customato. I also interviewed Thomas Hauser, who went up to the house in the Catskills to spend time with Cus and Tyson. You know, you're absolutely right to say that there has not been any complaint filed. What I found in extensively interviewing Cus D'Amato's biographer, so much evidence of what could have happened had been sealed. And I don't know what that portends to, but what my investigation was about is, why has so much been hidden? Why are Cus's and Jim Jacobs' medical records, FBI files, and Army records sealed?
Well, first of all, their medical records would be HIPAA, so that's bad. But, I mean, their Army records?
Their Army records and their FBI files. Cus was a very left-leaning person. So chances are he was being sort of followed by the FBI in terms of having communist sympathies. Teddy Atlas has gone on record to suggest that Cus D'Amato and Jim Jacobs were lovers, may have died of AIDS. That's in Jonathan Rendell's book, Scream.
Right, but I mean, once again, though, I mean, there's not any hard evidence to suggest this. But let me just ask you this. What my problem is this. You, after sort of saying that there's, I mean, well, maybe not saying, but implying that there is a broad and sort of deliberate conspiracy to sort of obscure these details, and that the boxing media are all sycophants because they all want press passes, and so they don't want to sort of piss off the powers that be by asking these questions. Yet later on in the interview, the podcast, which I normally would be a part of but was not a part of on that particular occasion, you gushed like a schoolgirl over being invited to Mike Tyson's house, and it's like, well, why didn't you ask him if Cus stuck it up his ass? Because
well, I
that
did.
Was the
I,
case.
I did, quite... I did ask Tyson on record whether or not, and I'm the first person to ever do it, whether or not he himself was sexually assaulted. Nobody ever asked him that question.
But you didn't say by Cus, though. I mean, you didn't hit where it hit home.
Well,
Can I just jump in here and say you're a brave man for asking Tyson that, by the way?
Yeah, you really actually. I will give you credit for that. Well, you're definitely a fucking brave man for asking that.
Well, hey, Tony, hang on.
Brave or not, I'm trying to be respectful, and I was interested in the welfare of the people who were staying in that household. My father's a child protection lawyer who instructed social workers for about 10 years in court procedure. Like, I also worked at his law firm for a period of time. Like, I was very interested in how somebody like him was able to secure so many young people. And as we've seen with Jerry Sandusky, you're an asshole to ask these questions until we find out there's some validity to what some of these suspicions are. And every reporter I spoke to suggested that this was an angle that had occurred to them, that there was weirdness associated with it. And again, these are not people who had any kind of axe to grind with Cus D'Amato, but there's a lot of stuff that I wasn't able to write about in the article that I did exploring Tyson 25 years after Buster Douglas. The off-the-record stuff was enormous about just the innuendo and strangeness of what was going on. People who'd spent years investigating him, including Cus's biographer, there was a lot of stuff there. But to your point, there is no formal record of anybody coming forward with a sexual complaint. Now, how many sexual complaints were there with Jerry Sandusky over the course of, what, 30 years? Not many. You know, with Michael Jackson sleeping in a bed with kids, is that in and of itself illegal? No, but it's suggestive of something that's a little bit troubling. And, you know, there's just a lot of stuff with this story that off the record is very different from what I can go on the record.
Well, I mean, you know, I understand that. And you know what? I haven't done the interviews that you've done, and I do have tremendous respect for your work. I do. But I just think there's something wrong with the fact, because there's no slant. I mean, I'm about to take the bar exam in February. Mm-hmm. I know, as I can tell you, that there's no such thing as the ability to slander or libel the dead, because they have no rights. They can't claim any damages in return. And so what I'm saying is that I think it's convenient to say, to basically strongly suggest this, and you're basically treading the line like very, very closely, and you're saying, well, you know, there's all this stuff off the record, and I can tell you, but I can't say this stuff. And so, I mean, you're basically saying it without saying it. You're not coming out and saying it. And then, and you know that even if you did, that there would be no legal repercussions to doing so. So why aren't you saying it? I mean, what's the stuff? Because I can tell you, if you want to consult a lawyer, you can do it. But I can tell you right now, people who are dead have no claims for libel or slander. So I'm just wondering what it is that is, you know, something that you can't really talk about if it's off the record. I mean, and there's no potential damages there. So come out and let it out.
Because it also relates to Tyson, doesn't it?
Yeah,
but that's just you could say people told you whatever you want. I can say Andy told me he had sex with a goat yesterday or sheep because he's in Scotland, so that would make more sense. But I mean, the point is, I could say that stuff, and there's no repercussions to that. That's just what you can't do is deliberately liberal or slander a dead person. So I mean, I'm just curious to see what it is, because I mean, it seems like a sexy story, and you say there's a widespread conspiracy to cover it up. You claim to have some sort of knowledge we all don't otherwise have. What is it?
Well, I think that there are certain pieces that you can put together. As far as numerous people have gone on the record to say that Customato was a homosexual, and many people off the record said the same thing. So the fact that Customato lives with Jim Jacobs, who many people also have suspected of being a homosexual over the decades, that they lived together for 10 years in a small Manhattan bedroom, that Jim Jacobs bought the house where they were living in the Catskills, where he had all these kids who Jim Jacobs was siphoning off into that household. I'm curious how Cuss was able to have this 18-bedroom Victorian mansion to house them. I guess, you know, and as I say, none of these people have come forward. None of the kids who passed through that house have come forward to say that anything improper happened to them. So, and I'm not trying to conflate being a homosexual with being a pedophile. Two very entirely different things.
Thank you. Yeah, I know. I understand what you're saying.
And so in that sense, you know, there are homosexuals who are interested in children. And when I hear that Customato is in bed with a teenaged Floyd Patterson, who Floyd later goes on record to say he feels that Cuss was sexually attracted to him, and Cuss, and you were saying earlier that Cuss was opposed to the mob. We know that Cuss was heavily involved with the mob. So that sounds like a cover story to me to justify his paranoia about maybe being outed for something else, because he was working with the mob with his fighters. So this whole narrative that he was the only honest guy in boxing standing up to it, all of that has been completely disproven as bullshit. So I suspect, the moment you accept, okay, if he was a homosexual, if Floyd Patterson as a teenage black troubled kid was his kind of type that he's grooming, and you listen to a lot of Tyson's language describing how Cuss oriented and calibrated him as a fighter and as a person, a lot of it sounds like textbook grooming behavior to me. Now, Jose Torres, another world champion that Cuss produced, hasn't gone on record to say that anything improper happened. So this is what speaks to my ambivalence about Cuss, is there is a lot of smoke to some strange things, some extremely eccentric behavior that raises a lot of flags. But I've been very clear to say nobody has filed a complaint that I'm aware of from up in the Catskills, or because a lot of his criminal records are sealed, we don't know what was really happening while he was operating in New York under incredibly secretive, he's notoriously secretive, and I'm trying to figure out why. He was in the military, he was going to become a priest early on, all of that is inventoried in his biography. There's a lot of strange, interesting, unusual stuff, and I've tried to investigate it. I have got a lot of people off the record to corroborate that, yes, he was a homosexual. Yes, his big business partner through life, Jim Jacobs, was also. Both of them had partners. Jacobs was married to a woman. She was on record to say that their marriage was, quote, unusual. you know, there's a lot of strange stuff here with it, and I was very interested just to try and find out, not to impugn this guy's reputation. I admire what he did as a boxing trainer. I admire, the effect that he seemed to have on Tyson was an extremely positive one, and I'm not squealing like a little girl because of, you know, Mike Tyson, you know, like I'm some star fucker. I really admired Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson's story was really instrumental to me in, I think, a lot of positive ways. I admire what he's been able to accomplish and overcome.
So yeah, I appreciate what you said also, because I thought it was spot on. You said there's been very, very few people, not just in boxing, but in, you know, sort of American entertainment / sports culture, who have been able to retain their sort of magnetically interesting quality over time. Like, still to this day, Mike Tyson is able to go on Broadway and sell out, you know, God knows how many shows, and it's been how many years since he's been out of the ring. We're always going to have that fascination about Tyson, yeah, and so forth. But I guess what it is that ultimately, here's my problem. If there was all these boys that went through Catskill, right, troubled folks, and we know how boxing is. Not everybody's career pans out. Not everybody's life pans out. There has to be someone out there who really, for whom things did not pan out. You would think that if they could make a few headlines and a few dollars off of bringing their story forward, that they would be in desperate enough circumstances to do so. But yet, no one ever has. And then there's just this compilation of, Cost was thinking about becoming a priest or something. And okay, well, you know, that has its own connotations. And, you know, you say, well, he never married and he lived up in a mansion and he was surrounded by young boys and supposedly his foot touched floor. I mean, it's just all these like things where it's just like you try to put together these little pieces, but you're not willing to come out and just sort of drop, you know, you say, well, I have evidence he was gay and this like that, but it's just like there's no smoking gun, and you would think if there's all these people you've been able to interview that somebody would be willing to go on the record, particularly when all of the principals involved primarily are dead.
Donny, you know yourself, mate, and especially in the UK, we had the very own Jimmy Savile who was up on, well,
exactly.
rumors about him for years.
Decades.
Decades. And it wasn't until he died people then started saying, okay, I can come forward.
Yes, but Costamato's been dead for years.
Yeah, but that's
years.
Not the point. If there's something going on in the background we don't know about, Bryn's obviously, he just says there, he knows more information than he can let on, right? I know people who know something about Floyd Mayweather that he can't fucking tell the information on. Surely to Christ, if he knows something's going on here, he's got to investigate it.
I think with the case for Jimmy Savile, it took someone to go to the police to give other people the confidence to do the same. Once one person said their story,
same with Bill Cosby, dozens and dozens of people coming out. Same with the yeah. Boston church situation that's in theaters right now with the film Spotlight.
Spotlight.
Thousands of people arrested by priests. It just wasn't coming out, you know. So,
but that's old news, though. I mean, that's from the 2000s.
Yeah, but boxing is a notoriously insular kind of group of people. And, you know, I found a lot of people who, I mean, as I say, there isn't, that I'm aware of, anybody on record who has come out to say they were sexually assaulted. So I've been explicit about that. But there's a lot of other suspicious stuff that people will not talk about. There's been an effort to conceal information, and I'm just curious why. And so I was, you know, trying as a reporter to explore that, and some people were gravely offended that I raised the issue in the first place. No,
I mean, here's what I'll respect. If are you still actively involved in the sort of attempt to get this story?
No, I wrote what I found from talking to people, from talking to Tyson directly. I was explicit in, you know, as I say, I'm the first person who asked him whether he was sexually assaulted. He put in his book and said somebody attempted it. I said, did it happen? And was it the only time?
Did you ask him if it was in prison?
No, he said it was in the street in Brownsville. When he moved to Brownsville, that somebody abducted him off the street and attempted to assault him sexually. And I said, and? Like, you just left it out. And nobody followed up with it. And so my next question was it the only time? And that left the door open, because I am trying to be respectful of him. Of if he wanted to go further with it, he could. He said no. He was also very explicit that he left out a number of items in his memoir because he knew the effect of them. I mean, Tyson has been very selective with the information that's come out. But I'll tell you another thing. I noticed that as I was typing up I was transcribing that interview with him, the next day Tyson went on radio and volunteered that conversation about being sexually molested. It was that much on his mind to just drop it on the public after whatever, I mean, I guess he's 49 years old, and it happened when he was 8 or 9 years old. That seemed rather interesting to me, that suddenly he would just sort of unpack it to the public as part of his narrative.
You know, fair enough. And what I would say is that, I mean, look, I think much like you, I know you said you grew up, Tyson was your hero. I think the same would be true for me. He was definitely my favorite fighter, and I can still remember back before he was, you know, sort of bad, right? I mean, he was the face of Nintendo and knocked drugs out of your life, and, you know, when he was the sort of American hero type and everything, and I remember all that. And so I guess what I would say is just that, you know, I mean, yes, I would like to believe that things were, maybe, of course, nothing is ever the way that it's hyped up to be and marketed as, but I would like to believe that, you know, a crazy, bizarre old boxing trainer in his late years and with all of his, you know, peculiarities or whatever, you know, took a guy in and taught him all of the peculiar psychological views that he had, and he kind of just branded it onto Tyson and made him a custom motto fighter, and, you know, he became what he became. I want to believe that. And if that's not true, I would hope that the truth would come out, especially if people were hurt. Especially if people were hurt. Of course I want to know.
Well, there was a lot of money to cover it up if something happened through Jim Jacobs. He was an extraordinary wealthy man. And I think the difference between you and I in regard to Tyson and Customato is you're looking to believe something and I'm looking to find something out. And those are opposite objectives.
But you just said you're not involved in an active investigation.
I'm not. But I'm saying I was when I was trying to dig up information and see what the truth was from as many different sources as I could find.
If you had come out with a truth that was, you know, I mean, potentially, you know, very, very damaging to Tyson, D'Amato, Jacobs, whoever, I wouldn't care about that. And especially, like I said, if people are hurt, of course, those people deserve justice in whatever way that, you know, 30 years later they could get it, at least if it's through, you know, the public sympathy and so on and so forth. But, I mean, you know, I guess what I'm saying is that if you went through all these efforts and you didn't come up with anything, and then it seems like, well, you know, I'm still just going to assert that this happened anyways and just sort of leave the questioning lingering out there, it seems like you're maligning the reputations of a lot of people who, you know, you didn't have enough evidence to come out and say it in the first place. And so you're just sort of softly saying it. And I just don't think I think you need to be more guarded about it if you weren't able to find any evidence, is all I'm saying.
Well, I think I was very upfront with what I was able to find, and I think you're in a bit of a difficult position because there's enough evidence that I think a lot of people are very curious to understand more. And the reason they are is because there's been way less evidence with people who were able to quite freely act out in this way, you know, as we've been saying with Jimmy Savile.
Yeah, but once that curiosity reaches that critical mass, right, like once that curiosity builds and builds and builds, usually that opens the door to something. It's opened the door with the Catholic Church scandal. It's opened the door with the Seville scandal over in England. It's opened the door with the Penn State thing. It's opened the door with, like, the curiosity and the questioning from the media reaches that critical mass, and then, you know, the sort of the floodgates open and, you know, we find out what really went on. Well, the questioning, it seems like, in the interviewing and all this stuff that you're talking about seems to have happened, except the lack of, you know, those floodgates opening and that information actually flowing out. I think that's what's missing. And so, I mean, I don't know. I just personally, you said I'm trying to believe something. I wouldn't say that's the case because, like I said, if it was true, I would want it to come out, obviously. But I'm just saying that if there isn't any evidence for it, I mean, do you really think it's appropriate to just continue to run with that narrative? Because you could run with that narrative if you found the information, but you just didn't find the information.
Well, I wrote one article about it, and I expressed what information I was able to find, and I think what you said is true of what my objective was that if people felt safe to finally come out, if it was indeed true, there was an opportunity to do it. So far, nobody has. Tyson was willing to go on record to say that he was sexually assaulted, which I think was my kind of feeling. He certainly didn't say it was Customato who did it. But, I mean, I think it did help to bring a lot of understanding to his character and what shaped him. But as it pertains to Cuss, you know, I found there was a lot of reporters saying that that's a vitally important story to explore. I tried, and I was pretty upfront about what I found and didn't find. So people can do with that what they like. There's nothing there to indict him or anything like that. I don't think I said anything to slander him beyond the information that I found.
Yeah, and no, actually, I think, you know, your answers have been really upfront. And also, I mean, to be honest with you, I wasn't aware of, I mean, all of the investigation that you did. And when I first listened to that interview, and we didn't get in depth, or I shouldn't say I wasn't a part of it, but the pod did not get as in depth with you as we have gotten right now. But at that particular time, when I had listened to the details of what you had to say, I had remembered the Sutton article. So I went back and I had compared and contrasted all of the information that you had provided in that original podcast interview with the information in the Sutton article, and there actually wasn't that much difference. So yeah. My assumption initially before speaking with you was that you were just sort of throwing that out there, that you were putting sort of a dramatic spin on it and implying the existence of a conspiracy, but, you know, without any further information. It sounds to me, and, you know, like I said, I've read your other work, and it's obviously high quality stuff, and, you know, a lot better than some of the crap that we get in the boxing world of today, where, you know, I mean, people a lot of times, like you said, are sycophants, and I respect the level of investigation that you went to get this. It is unfortunate. It seems like you maybe have gotten stonewalled or something, but I definitely respect that. And now that I have more information that you actually did the homework, I guess maybe, yes, there's some questions out there, and yes, perhaps we'll never know. But I am happy to hear that it was more than just that. And so that's my piece. I just had a bit of a bone to pick with you, but I'm satisfied. And just so you know, this isn't anything personally against you. If you ever listen to the Eddie Hearn interview on here, he got quite a bit of a treatment in the frying pan, if you know what I mean. And he came out alive to tell the tale. So I respect you for being as decent as you have been to take what I know has been, I hope, have been respectful questions, but also questions that I think, you know, I would probably make you a little bit uncomfortable. It is a bit confrontational, but that's we believe in respectful confrontation here, and I respect your answers. So thank you.
Well, no, I appreciate you raising these questions. I think these questions deserve to be raised, and you know, I do take pride in the work that I've done profiling people and interviewing people that I'm respectful and I try to be ethical. And you know, and as I say, Tyson in particular has a lot of personal meaning to me. So what I found with Tyson was when I raised the idea with other reporters and people who knew him and people who knew Cuss and raise some of these questions that I had regarding Cuss and the background there, all of them, when I went even to the extreme of the Jerry Sandusky, and I mean, the moment I talked to Gay Talese, for example, who's in his early 80s, to mention that he had seen, he characterized it as a sexual attraction between Cuss and Floyd Patterson. He was incredibly defensive, just that I raised what he had gone on the record to say and said to me, you know, are you gay? You know, it's like, no, you know, what does that have to do with this question? You know, you're conflating this with Jerry Sandusky. Well, no, I'm raising what you've gone on the record to talk about and just trying to investigate a little further, which is also what Gay Talese is quite famous for. So every reporter I spoke to thereafter about the possibility of Cuss, not the homosexuality stuff, which almost everybody confirmed, But is there a chance of something like pedophilia? Is there something in knowing him, in being up at the house in the Catskill? Is there something about this that's worthy of investigation? All of them said absolutely. All of them. And for me, I felt some obligation to the people who may have stayed there. And we know when kids get sexually assaulted, how they internalize the shame of it. Cuss had all the power in that household. He had all the connections. There's a lot of textbook stuff there when it comes to grooming troubled youth and being able to get away with something like this. So I felt like I owed it to them journalistically to really try to get as much information as I could. But to your point, I never found any hard evidence against them, and I was trying to be very upfront and transparent about that, which is a difficult line to walk of not slandering a person who a lot of people respect, but also being fair to people who possibly were damaged as a result of staying with them. And a number of people were very damaged who lived in that house. It's not his fault, but I just wanted to learn more about it, and just seemed like very muddy waters all the way along with Customato's story and his history, and a lot of that history was muddied by himself. And I'm not quite sure still to this day why, and neither was a biographer who spent 8 years investigating it. We spent a lot of time talking, and it was troubling and fascinating at the same time.
So, Don, are you happy with that?
I'm a highly satisfied customer, yes.
Okay, good. Thank you.
It's like Customato's customers.
Oh, dear man. Right, we'll move on. I've got a few Twitter questions to dive through here. Quite a few. Unless anybody's got questions, want to ask Bryn if can I shed any more light?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead, Donnie.
Chris will be here for fucking till next Sunday. If Donnie keeps asking him questions. Anybody else got any questions for him?
No, I think they've explained that pretty well.
Yep.
I think you should just stay on the pod, because I think actually I need to drop off, so if there's a space concern, I can certainly get going.
Well, Bryn, do you fancy hanging around, mate? I mean, we have got some fights to review for next week, Klitschko, etc. and stuff, but we have got some Twitter questions to get through as well on their well-respected Billy the Week award, so if you want to hang about, mate, it's up to yourself.
Yeah, I'm happy to.
Right, good stuff.
But I'm not talking about elderly possible pedophiles anymore.
I think that subject has been done to death.
Okay.
That's good. Right, I think we've got Adam back on the line as well. I think we've got Alex back as well. So let me think here. Adam,
yeah,
we've got
Andy,
a question.
I got a paper to write, so I'm gonna bow out. But right. I want to thank Jonathan for his time, and have a good one.
Donnie, are you still there?
Yeah.
Right. Listen, I want you to work on something. I want you to learn how to answer, ask a question without having to fucking write an essay to do it.
All right. Take care.
Well done, Donnie. I'm kidding you on, mate. Well done.
What's that?
I said, I'm kidding you on. Well done.
All right. Take care.
Cheers.
Night.
Right. Adam, I've got a question here from Adam Tinsley. He's asking, do you think the man who beat Chilemba is calling Hay out for the payday, or does he think he could win as Hay fighting again at heavyweight?
Payday. It's got payday written all over it. He's a boring fighter, and I want Masternek to knock him out.
So someone that tweeted, I forget the name actually, someone tweeted me the other week there saying that without doubt in his mind, or from information he's been given, David Hay can make cruiserweight.
Oh, I don't doubt it. I don't doubt it can make cruiserweight. I think David Hay didn't grow into heavyweight. I think he moved up to heavyweight. You know, for obvious reasons, but yeah, he can definitely make cruiserweight, and he would beat Tony Bellew with no problem. David Hay could come back, no warm up fight, straight in Bellew, knock him out. Thank you very much.
Well, apparently he's going to be announced on Tuesday that he's coming back, and he's going to be fighting that Mark DeMori guy. He's got a decent looking
record.
That
New Zealand guy.
Yeah, but yes. I mean, in terms of Bellew and Hay, I mean, listen, if you're Tony Bellew, in all seriousness, why won't you call out the fight? I mean, that would be a pay per view fight. They both talk it up, and Bowie can get a payday. Yeah, we'll all expect him to get knocked out, but from a financial standpoint, why won't you take the fight? If there's any chance that can be made, I can see why Bowie would want it.
That's life-changing money for Bowie, that.
I wouldn't be surprised if Hay could make cruiserweight. You know, he's done the Sting before, hasn't he? If you remember before the Macronelli fight, he was all for moving up to heavyweight. Frank Macronelli and all them thought, oh, he's struggling like mad at cruiserweight, trying to get himself down to the weight. They thought they had the advantage then. Hay came in, bang, see you later. I wouldn't be surprised if Hay wouldn't pull that card again.
The thing with Hay is he doesn't like to run all that, does he? You know, he's most of his work's done actually in a gymnasium. He doesn't do any road work or that, eh?
I've done a lot of weights, so maybe what I'm told, if he stays off the weights, then he should be able to make drop the muscle and get down to 200 pounds.
If you look at the short clip of him training with Shane McGuigan, he looks quite big in that. I don't think you'll ever see him anywhere near cruiserweight.
Well, Shane's all about the fitness, isn't he? That's his sort of his big thing, and that was why it was so strange whenever Frampton supposedly struggled with the weight against Gonzalez, because Shane is he's the sports scientist and all that. So Hay, that'll suit Hay down to the ground.
Who have we got here? Alex, you back, mate?
Yeah, I'm here.
Got a question here from Tony Nelson. Today marks the first anniversary of the Bellew Cleverly rematch. My question for the pod is, what will be the worst pay-per-view on paper? AJ against White or Bellew?
On paper, you've got to say AJ White, because it's obviously a gross mismatch on paper. I mean, beforehand, obviously. You know, Bellew Cleverly, we at least expected, and it was, to be fair, a close fight. It was competitive in the loosest sense of that term, you know, awful fight to watch, but competitive and 50-50 at least. So, yeah, most people, I think, expect Joshua to absolutely obliterate White. So, and if you're buying a pay-per-view, you surely expect, decent fights and equal fights.
Tommy, Callum, sorry mate, on you go.
I thought about this question earlier. I think like the November pay-per-view last year, when they stacked it, McDonald with a paper championship and Quigg with a paper championship. But I think this December the 12th one's better, to be fair. I was never really excited by Bellew Cleverly 2. It obviously disappointed on the night, but I'm more excited. I'm not saying it's acceptable, but I'm more excited by December the 12th than I was last year.
Okay. Tommy, Callum Bell's got two questions in here. What's more offensive in terms of width, fat Terry O'Connor's belt or the 116-111 Murray Abraham scorecard?
It's going to be fat Terry's belt, even though that was fucking a horrible scorecard then. What kind of fucking questions is that, man? Your questions are getting shit these days, aren't they?
Right, well, I'll give you the second question then.
Fucking hell. Who the hell's who's listening to this podcast out there, man? Jesus Christ.
I'll ask you the second question. It says, rank Crawler, Mitchell, Flanagan, Campbell and Burns. And does Crawler have a chance against Linares?
I went through this the other one, I think the best lightweight in the country is Luke Campbell. I think Ricky Burns is the second best lightweight. Flanagan third. Mitchell, I'm not sure, is the same fighter. Can he be the same fighter after Linares? So I'll maybe put Crawler above him. But that's how I'd have him. What was the other part of the question?
Does Crawler have a chance against Linares?
Absolutely no chance. Linares would absolutely destroy him, man. Linares is a really, really talented fighter. He's actually, for me, he's one of the most talented fighters in the world. He's not the toughest around, though, but talent-wise, he's incredible.
Tremendous. Bryn, I've got a question here, and from Simon, he's asking, Buddy McGirt against Tim Bradley, who would win?
Would win? Buddy McGirt?
Obviously, it's a rhetorical question, I think. Obviously, if it prime for prime, if they were still, facing off today.
So you're trying to say there's a house on fire, and we need a fireman?
Yep.
Then I think if Teddy Atlas is with Bradley, he's our guy.
Putting fires right over the place. I went with McGirt, actually. I mean, McGirt was a good fighter, but I think he was no prone to injuries. I think he had problems with his rotator cuffs and stuff like that as well. But the dog and Bradley, man, you just don't know. It could be a close fight as well, eh?
No, Bradley was very impressive, I thought, against Rios. I mean, I don't know how much Rios really has left, but I quite enjoyed that fight. I mean, generally, I haven't really liked watching his fights, but his punch selection, his tenacity, Teddy Atlas's lunacy in the corner, I mean, he's watchable now. It was good.
Okay.
That was a tough first question for him, man. Jesus.
Right. Okay.
I like that one myself.
Oh, I didn't know what. What fights have you seen this week, Bryn? Just so I can get all the questions in there.
Well, Rigondeaux, Cotto, Canelo. I'm looking forward to Klitschko and Tyson Fury. Who have you guys already covered that?
No, we'll be doing that in a wee bit. We'll be doing that in a little bit.
I'm looking forward to that conversation.
Did you catch the Vargas fight?
I did. That was a great fight, and they're all pedophiles. All of them.
Especially Jim Lampley.
Oh, Christ.
I just have to get it out of my system, you know.
I'll just edit that bit out of this whole podcast and post that up.
I've got one here for you, Bryn. Darren Parsons, was Rigo his own worst enemy last night? If he'd upped the pace, the boos might have been silenced. Did the corner say up it now? Aye, I think that's what he did. Up the pace.
I think he absolutely bears a lot of the responsibility. If you have a journeyman of that caliber in front of you, you have to put him away. I mean, if you're top four pound-for-pound fighter in the world, I just think it's a reasonable expectation that you just dispose of that kind of caliber of opposition, you know, and you do it decisively and impressively. You were saying that that's what you were intending to do, to make statements with your fights that had publicity like this on an HBO pay-per-view card. I think that's a reasonable expectation. I think it's incumbent upon him. He's 35 years old. He's undefeated. He's got to start making some of these statements and be willing to fight elite guys who are going to challenge him. I was disappointed that his opponent, like Agbeko, offered him nothing in the way of leading the fight. This was a guy with almost, I think, 30 fights, 22 knockouts, and Rigo so intimidated him with his counterpunching prowess that he just refused to throw anything at him. But if that's the case, you have to adapt and I think provide some entertainment value. And his indifference to that is just frustrating and disappointing. It was, I think, the worst fight of his career as a professional.
Let me see. Steve. Could Hearn so this is from D-Dog. Could Hearn and Warren ever work together to co-promote Flanagan versus Crawler in a stadium fight?
Well, initially I would say no, but money talks, and I think if there's enough money on the line, anybody, any promoter in the world will work together. I do not believe there is anybody who is exempt from working together when the money's right, so would they? Yes, for that particular fight. I don't think it would be big enough to bring them together. No, is my answer.
I don't know if you could. I mean, you couldn't even sell it as a Man United, Man City rivalry there, could you? I mean, if it Rangers Celtic, maybe, yeah, but...
Nah, it would have to be an absolute blockbuster, I think, to bring them together.
No,
I don't think
really cares about Flanagan, do they? I mean, I like him. No, it's not
going to
happen.
Yeah. Alex, Marcus Bellinger's asking, why the hell do we need the secondary ticketing sites with social media being so prevalent?
Well, you know, I discussed this on another podcast on Friday, I think it was, you know, about ticket touts and things like that, and I think there's a lot of, you know, similarly, I suppose, without much evidence myself, but I just think there's a lot of, you know, maybe conspiracy and corruption going on with these guys. I think there's a lot of, you know, promoter involvement with secondary ticket markets, and you know, Eddie Hearn's association with StubHub is really the crux of my issue, what I had with it. You know, the fact, even if he's got a legitimate business relationship with them, why is he being sponsored by a company that, you know, essentially fleeced the fans, fleeced the boxing fans, you know, forced them to end up paying at least, you know, I saw tickets on there four or five times the face value, it's a joke, you know, £60 tickets on there for, you know, £200-£300 on there is absolutely ridiculous. And, you know, for him to have this business relationship where, you know, they sell face value tickets on Matchroom, it's just him, you know, giving them revenue purely by sending them to the website, and, you know, he gets something out of it too. And I think that the fact that he's even supporting a website that has this kind of business practice going on, it's completely disgusting, and I think the whole thing is disgusting. It needs regulating. I think it's quite regulated in football at the moment, isn't it? I think, you know, touts are pretty much wiped out in that sense, but you know, maybe there should be sort of government involvement with that.
I actually owned myself actually on Friday because I was off work, and Tommy's mum gratefully was online for us trying to get us tickets for Frampton against Quigg. And when I seen some of the prices for the secondary ticket market, so the ticket that I wanted was £150, which was actually kind of like middle tier. She ended up getting me a £150 ticket, but it was actually one of the £40 tickets from the bleachers. So I was actually, when I was like, I said to myself, right, okay, there's no way I'm paying that for a shit ticket, so I'm just going to go to Klitschko against Hay instead, against Fury instead. But then I messaged Tommy's mum, and she says to me, I've got the tickets. I went, oh, no. But what can I do?
He's a fucking idiot, Murray.
I was sure I got fair play for getting the tickets and stuff like that, but then I forgot to let her know that I wasn't getting ripped off, but then it looks like I'll need to pay it anyway. So, thanks to your mum, Tommy. Cheers for that. What else we got? I've got some questions here relating to ISIS. Anybody wants to answer these?
Questions related to ISIS.
I'll take that one. Let's do it.
Paco's saying is, if you wanted to torture an ISIS detainee, which fight would you make him watch? Rigo, Ward, or Devon Alexander?
Oh, fuck. I thought the question was going to be, what fighter would you like to see tortured by ISIS? And my answer was going to be Miguel Cotto, but...
Devon would quit, so it wouldn't be him, because it might not last very long.
No offence to ISIS if you're listening, by the way, guys.
Sorry, what was the question? Sorry.
It says, which fighter, if you wanted to torture an ISIS detainee, which fighter would you make him watch, Rigo, Ward, or Devon Alexander?
Oh my God, man. I'm a big fan of Rigo, and I've defended him a lot, but that last night was just fucking unacceptable. I've never seen Alexander or Ward in a stinker like that before. That was fucking horrendous.
I've never seen Ward or Alexander Nolan say just land seven punches around.
Aye, exactly.
The above and just make them watch Yusuf Mack.
And the dog pound.
Yeah. I don't see it. People cry about the boring styles constantly, but, I mean, Rigo's hit and miss. The Agbeko fight and last night were obviously career lows. But I think he's actually a real pleasure to watch a lot of the time. I thought, even though Dan Raphael cried so miserably about the Donaire fight, I thought that was really fun to watch. But either way, I think some of the time you have to criticize his opponent as well. Like Bryn was saying, Agbeko and Francisco didn't throw shit. So yeah. I mean, he does what he can to get the win. And I mean, with the Donaire fight, we're talking about a 3-1 favorite. That Donaire was favored over Rigo. Rigo outthrew him, outlanded, and my scoring had 11-1 against Donaire. I mean, that kind of dominance. And every time Raphael references that fight, he's like, "Oh, Rigo won a decision." It was not just a decision. That if Mayweather did that against Pacquiao, it would be the masterpiece of his career as far as Raphael would be concerned. You know, I agree with exactly what he said. Like, that last performance of Rigo was just, and Agbeko were just, ugh, beyond the pale, boring. Even for people like us who really admire him, terrible.
Just wrapping up the last of these questions here, guys. Kurt, Brian King's asking, is Canelo the new Chavez Senior in terms of judges? I'm including the Floyd fight as well.
Well, the card in the Floyd fight was horrible. Everyone knows that. But I think with the fights like Trout and Lara, I mean, I think they were generally close fights that, you know, they could have gone either way. And, you know, I don't think anyone would say any of those are robberies. It's just that I think it's not just Canelo, it's all these big A stars. Whenever they're, you know, in a close fight, they always be the guy who will get it. You know, that's just how the sport is, and I don't think it's just limited to Canelo. It's anyone, whether it be Mayweather, it be Pacquiao, it be, you know, Klitschko. Yeah. If the fight is close, you're not going to really see the B side get it, in my opinion, especially as the crowd play a part as well. They're cheering everything, but I mean those cards were bad, but to be honest, I could see a judge giving Canelo 10 rounds, in my opinion. I mean, I had it a bit closer, but I could see it. I think giving Cotto one round is quite harsh, but I could see, you know, 10 rounds to Cotto. I can see that, to be honest.
And finally, I'll give this
one. I felt that way, too. Sorry, I just felt that way, too. I just seemed like Cotto was surviving the fight. I admired a really valiant effort, but I just thought Canelo looked so strong and powerful, that, and Canelo looked so impotent to really assert himself, that even 10-2, I can see it. I didn't score it that way, but I wasn't offended by that.
No.
I just lost that question. Dave, Joe Gray, Dave, I'll give you these last two questions, mate. Joe Gray asks, why are fighters allowed to dictate a weight below the class limit for world title fights? And Panzer's asking, is Canelo in the shit when he moves up, doesn't have a huge size advantage over opponents, stamina is crap, struggles cutting off the ring?
Well, why they're allowed to is because, unfortunately, it's not a sport anymore. It's just a free country, and you can negotiate whatever the hell you want. And that's why boxing is in the shit right now, in my opinion. It's really, really depressing as to how much business controls things. But thankfully, as far as the other question, Canelo is absolutely in the shit when it comes to Golovkin, and I don't really see any way he wins that fight, barring some kind of lucky mega punch. I mean, he impressed me slightly in the Trout fight when he was a little bit more talented than I thought he was. But since then, again, I've been underwhelmed every time except for Angulo and Kirkland. But the other fights, I mean, he just doesn't impress. He doesn't get dominant wins over top competition the way like a guy like Manny Pacquiao or Floyd does. He's not the next big thing, and I think Golovkin is his. Golovkin is the death of him.
Andy, you're muted.
Damn, I was on mute there. Sorry, guys. Trying to make myself here. Right, that's the last of the Twitter questions. It is going to be a slightly longer show this week, so we'll just dive on to the Billy the Week segment very briefly, and then we'll get on to the fight previews for next week. The first nomination I've got up is, let me see. First one goes to Andrew Selby when he was asked about pound for pound number one, Roman Gonzalez, saying he would box his head off. Sky Sports.
Did he say he also had no skill as well?
Did he say that as well, mate?
He added some sort of comment about Roman Gonzalez has no skill. He just comes forward and acts tough.
Christ. Sky Sports for, they've got their, the you know, what do you call it again? Catch-up. Catch-up TV. They actually had the Burns versus King up on the planner. And they actually had the picture of Scotty Cardle defeating against Masher Dodd.
Burns versus Brian King.
Yep. Josh King. Did I say Brian King?
No.
Oh, God. Eddie Hearn for saying banter juice. I think he must have tried to think of something smart. I really think he must have tried to think of something smart, and it was the only thing he could come up with or something. You know, I just really don't know what happened there, but that's.
I'm going to tweet that to him. Banter juice.
Robin Deacon for
tweeting. You'll be on the camera.
Used to in bed with each other. Adam, are you giving your missus one while I'm talking on this podcast?
No, Andy, you provide more than enough excitement. I don't need any more excitement while I'm on the podcast with you.
All right, so Mrs. Listen, I'm not going to even bother asking that question. We've got guests on the show this week, so I better not be too crude. Right, Robin Deacon for tweeting out on the Hey Bellew fight scenes. I think Bellew is too young and hungry. Stay retired, David Hay, and enjoy the retirement. That one's for Jake Kearney. Now, I must have deleted this by mistake, so I've actually forgot. There's one in here from Sky Sports. I don't know what it's about again. I must have deleted it by mistake. This one came in via Paul Carpenter. He says, can I put forward a Bell of the Week nomination, please? The Fight Depot on Facebook, with over 1 million followers, put out a video titled, This Man is Better Than Floyd Mayweather. The video is of Callum Smith, but then halfway through I noticed it's also of Rocky Fielding. Got another one coming here. If I can find his name, a guy called Levi Gillis on Instagram. Paul Smith Jr. actually tweeted saying, "I'm so, so happy and proud of my mate tonight. Champion of the world, never ever gave up." And then Levi Giles came back and says, "Imagine Danny Garcia versus Anthony Crawler. What a fight that would be." Two different weight classes.
Casual.
Yep. Spencer Fearon says, he gets asked a question, I think that would be a massive step down for Murray to fight Paul Smith. And Fearon comes back and says, "No way, both are world class. It's a great fight."
That's what annoys me, that whole term world class, because you fight for a title and you get, you know, beaten in it. I mean, how does that make you world class?
Yeah, I know.
If only Andre Ward and Alexander Brand had fought, Alexander Brand would have been world class.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, first of all, I'm going to pull rank and say Tony Bellew doesn't get the award because it's his award and he cannot be voted for it.
Of
I think
course that's he can. He's won the award plenty.
Oh, you did. Right, okay. Right. Brad, you ever played this game before, mate, no?
It's my first time.
Your first time, right. Have I heard of Bellew the Week before, no?
No, but I'm open.
Right, okay. Bellew the Week's basically in favor and honorary of Tony Bellew, who's like, you probably hear him chat a few times. He speaks quite outlandish, says some funny things, some downright fucking stupid things and stuff. So in his honor, we look for all the funny comments, either, you know, retarded or whatever it is, and we make an award in Tony Bellew's honor.
Gotcha.
You know, like, Tony Bellew's going to be in the movie Creed releasing this week as the main antagonist, I believe, so that's something to be excited about.
And he knows about it as well, Bryn. He's very well aware. He's had a go at us via the YouTube medium.
Yep.
Okay, so he deserves it, is what you're saying.
Yeah, but I think he would probably get the Panamanian champion recess type title. You know, that organization has banned on this podcast because we're just refusing to give really any publicity to them, especially by the proper name anyway, because there's all it is an extortion body who's just full of corruptions. So if you've got anything you can think of, mate, anything funny, outlandish or anything like that, throw it in. Adam, you got any nominations this week, mate?
Yep. Oh shit, where was it going? I've got one for Paul Webb, actually. This one was sent in by our friend called Chad Hogan. Paul Webb tweeted, "Caballero may not bother weighing in again today, but both he and Haskins aren't going to walk away from a HBO televised world paid bout." So that one's gone. I've got one from Paco, and his on Twitter is @S7UAT. Khan saying he'll bring the big fights to Bolton's Macron Stadium. Thought that was quite good. I'm giving one to Martin Murray's manager, as mentioned earlier, because he was celebrating. And then I've got one coming in from CW, who is @WhiteheadUnited11. Roy Jones has just said Canelo has big fights available at 147 and 154. Is he going to cut his leg off?
Apparently, just regarding the Khan thing you mentioned there, apparently there is some kind of consortium which are trying to buy out Bolton Football Club because they're in a lot of debt, and there is an agreement as part of this that Khan is supposed to be fighting there. Now, whether it being the big fights or not, I don't know, but there is an element of truth to that, so here.
What, Haroon Khan?
Right, what I'll do is, if anybody got any nominations whatsoever, because I know we're running kind of strapped for time.
Sky commentary and Johnny Nelson, they had a mayor on last night.
Okay.
Another one on the Sky Sports website when they're talking about Pele Reed knocking out Vitaly Klitschko in the kickboxing tournament and they used a picture of Julius Francis.
Sky Sports website have been absolutely incredibly poor the last two or three weeks. Dreadful. Think people get paid for that shit. It's absolutely horrendous.
Does anyone have any clues actually writing the stuff on there?
It's got to be the boy that makes the tea for Johnny Nelson and all the rest of them. It's some unpaid intern, and he types it up and makes a billion mistakes after he Googles and picks the first picture up that you can find. Fucking useless.
Rumours are it's Paul Webb.
John Watts, my nomination anyway, because he was fucking horrendous last night, man.
You, any nominations, guys? Any other nominations?
No.
Right, okay. So as follows, Andrew Selby, Sky Sports, multiple offences. Again, this is for the third week running. Eddie Hearn, Robin Deacon, Tony Bellew, some Facebook page, Levi Gillis and Spencer Fearon, and the list that guys gave us. So, Adam, who's your winner?
Banter Juice.
Banter Juice, Eddie Hearn. Bryn, anything takes your fancy, mate?
I'm going to pass.
Pass. Kurt?
Multiple Offences by Sky.
Okay. Okay. Dave?
I'm going to give it to those cunts who said, what does Matt Murray have to do to get a decision when they had him losing?
Well, the thing is, someone just mentioned one more as well, Barry Hearn's press conference.
Rematch in England.
Abraham needs to come to Manchester to fight Martin Murray, give him his, you know, deserved rematch.
Alex?
Yeah, Andrew Selby.
Andrew Selby. Chris, we'll have to hand out fucking palladium titles and stuff like that this week, silver titles and all that stuff. Steve?
I'm going to go with Dave for the commentary team on Sky.
We've got a leader here so far. Tommy?
Sky,
is that the commentary?
Commentary team, mate, yep.
Right, okay. I'm going to pick for Sky as well. So well done to Sky Sports. Once again, for third week running, you are the Belly the Week Award winner. Right.
They've got that up on the website already, Andy, apparently. They've got your name spelt wrong.
They called it the Cleverly of the Week.
Right. Alright, I know we're running at what we're running at here, running at 2 hours 20 minutes, so I'll just very briefly run through next week's schedule and then we'll discuss the main fight we're all looking forward to. But on Wednesday, Erislandy Lara defends his Panamanian light middleweight title against Jan Javik. Must be a PBC card that guy's there. Saturday sees Elder Alvarez against Isaac Chalimba. Let's see who beats him. And James the Gale faces off against Lucien Bouty for his super middleweight title. Card from Japan, Pedro Guevara faces off against Yao Kimura, and Carlos Kudras is in action against Koko Eto. That might be a decent fight, that actually. Eto's actually got a fair bit of distance on him, actually, as well, so it could be interesting, that. And Saturday sees Errol Spence Jr. against Alejandro Barrera, and Jermell Charlo against Winky Campfort, which is some number 14 ranked IBF contender. But it seems to be a one-fight card next week, guys. Vladimir Klitschko defends his numerous heavyweight titles against Tyson Fury. I don't know where to start. Tommy, you're obviously going to be pulling for Big Fury, but I know where your heart's sitting, mate. I know where your heart's really going to be sitting. But I'll go with Kurt first. Kurt, you're the big Klitite. You're the one that defends a man through thick and thin water. Take it away, bud.
Well, I think it's going to be we all hope it's going to be a good fight, and I think it will be. I think I've said it before that, you know, against men of his own size, I think people give Fury a chance because of his size, and they're saying, you know, Vlad can't hold, he can't bully him like he can, but I actually look at it another way, that Vlad's actually more aggressive against men his own size or around that height. The littler guys, he tends to hold them, and they come in and there's always clinches, but with big guys, he has to let the big shots go. I mean, we saw it against Tony Thompson. He was right-hand happy. Marius Wacky was throwing right hands from the opening bow. And Kubrat Pulev is also a big man of like 6'5". He was left hook happy. So I think, you know, it's for Fury to win the fight, I can't see him outpointing Vlad. He's going to have to try and do what Pulev did, in my opinion, make Vlad fight at a pace he's not comfortable with, because he likes getting in his rhythm. And if he can outlast Vlad in that kind of fight, then he can do what Ross Purity did all those years ago and Lamont Brewster. I mean, if Pulev could have got through that those 6th, 7th round, maybe, you know, he could have been interesting, but he just couldn't do it. And when you punch as hard as Klitschko, there's not many people who are going to be able to take that. And I don't think Fury will myself. I'm not sure how he's going to box. I think if he comes out southpaw, he gets ended pretty quickly. I think he should look to box off the back foot, but I just can't see how he's going to do it. I mean, if he can try and take it to Vlad and try and push him back, but he just doesn't have the power. I mean, everything in this fight, you know, goes in Klitschko's favour in terms of experience, power, I'd say speed, you know, everything's there. And it would have been good to see Fury in with a big man, someone who we could see how he could get on, because against the likes of Chisora and even Steve Cunningham, who gave him massive problems, he was able to bully him and outbox him, but we've never really seen him in with a big guy or even a puncher, and I think that's where it's going to be a bit too soon for him. But I do think Fury can go on to be a force in the division and pick up a world title because he's improving all the time. But I just think he's a bit too soon for him myself.
With that, Bryn, is it too soon for Fury, do you think? Can he hold up to Klitschko's power? Or do you see maybe, you know, Tyson maybe slipping in a wee surprise here, maybe going southpaw?
I'd enjoy it if he was able to surprise him, but Klitschko has just looked very solid the last several years after he made those adjustments after losing. So it's hard to imagine Fury. I just don't see him having the skill set to really trouble Klitschko. Could get lucky. I'd love to see him. But, yeah, I was going to ask you all, do you think that this version of Klitschko would have given Lennox Lewis more problems than Vitaly did during their fight?
Tommy?
Good question.
I think Vlad's actually a better fighter than Vitaly is, but I'm not sure that it would give Lewis a better fight because Vitaly is obviously tougher and Lewis is going to land on Vlad, isn't he? Well,
the question is, would if they were in close, right, I know they were a wee bit in a clinch at the time, Vitaly and Lennox, if Lennox, who was out of shape, that uppercut, if he landed that uppercut on Vladimir, does he fold?
That was probably the best uppercut I've ever seen. Definitely.
That don't
Vladimir
out
that.
You agree with that one, Bryn?
Yeah, I mean, I still see Lewis winning both of those fights, frankly, especially if he was in shape. Like, an out-of-shape Lewis still was giving Vitaly a world of trouble. I mean, full respect to Vitaly for that fight. I thought that was a tremendously exciting fight. But I could see Lewis still winning that fight. I know he was losing on the scorecards. I just think Vitaly had an extra gear in terms of, like you said, his toughness and his tenacity, and I think he had a better, I think he has a better chin than his brother also.
I mean, Vitaly took that fight on, was it 9 days' notice as well, wasn't it?
So yeah, maybe, I think so. I think it was an undercard. Was he fighting Kirk Johnson?
No, Lewis was meant to fight in Cup Zone. That's right, yes.
But Vitaly was meant to be on the card as well. They just swapped opponents. They went together and fought together, didn't they?
That was a brilliant gesture. You don't see that type of stuff at such a high level coming off like that, if you think about it, really.
Yeah.
I think the question is actually an interesting one, because even though we all agree that Vlad's better now, but really what you're saying is he's more hard to beat now. But in terms of a Lewis fight, I think if you're looking at Klitschko knocking out Lewis, like Oliver McCaw and Haseem Rahman did, I think that version of Klitschko, the 2002, the 2001 version, is much more likely to knock out Lennox Lewis than this version is, because he's safety
more first. More aggressive.
Whereas that one, if you watch his fights then, it's a totally different fighter. He's a guy who's throwing all different shots. He's looking for the knockout. He's looking to hurt his guy. That is ultimately what cost him fights, because he was more exposed and he tired quickly. But in terms of getting to Lewis's chin, which I don't think Lewis had a bad chin, but in terms of that, I think he's probably more likely to get the knockout. But this version, if he's going to win, I'd say it's more of a points job. But it's a tough one to start, in my opinion.
What do you think, Steve?
I think, yes, I think he would. He would give him a bit more trouble. But I say I have a lot of respect for Vitaly for jumping in. Vitaly was very tough. But Klitschko has made a lot of adjustments, and I think he would have given that version of Lennox a lot of trouble. I'm a big Lennox fan. I think an in-shape Lennox deals with Vladimir, not comfortably, but handily. But I think now, if it was that version of Lennox going in with this version of Vladimir, then I think he would have given him a lot of trouble here.
Bryn, you're going to say something there, mate?
Oh, just... No, I lost it.
Okay. Dave the hater, I know you're going to have some strong comments here regards to his fight next week. You'll be pulling for Fury, no doubt.
I'm pulling for him, and he's going to do it. I tell you, I think the reverse of Kurt. I think Fury has the advantage here. I think Fury can do more things. He can fight inside. I think he's faster. I think he's got better stamina. He is bigger slightly. He's just more versatile than Vlad. We saw Vlad, in my opinion, look his worst that he's done in quite some time against Brian Jennings. I had that a 7-5 fight. Jennings outlanded him in power shots. Vlad punched himself in the face, the same we saw Tyson Fury do early in his career. I think Fury's come a fair long way since then. Vlad apparently has regressed, or he's getting old, I don't know, but he could never fight inside. Doesn't throw to the body. Fury can throw to the body. Fury can fight inside. It's going to, I think, I'm hoping, and I'm believing that what it's going to look like is some sort of Riddick bow. I think if Tyson takes it inside, he can smother Vlad and still get his own punches off, tire out the older man, and hopefully stop him late. I think if it goes to points, Fury's going to deserve it. But we will see if he gets it, because of course, what?
Talk to me about Fury's chin.
Well, talk to me about Vlad's chin.
Ah, but can we, how often are you going to keep saying this about Vlad?
Old three times. Corey Sanders, bitch, and always will be.
Who is
Fury
it?
Fury gets up when he gets dropped.
What was I going to say? I don't say during the week that Fury actually may get knocked doing my jab in this fight.
You will. I'm standing by that.
Right. There's actually one guy in the fight who has been knocked down by a jab before, and it's no Tyson Fury.
Right. This fight, I think, is quite straightforward. Vlad is more aggressive against taller guys. I don't think Fury has got the stamina. I don't think Fury has got the chin. I'm pretty sure Fury's not got the intelligence. The easiest way and the most likely way Fury is to win this fight is to come out early and try and smash Vlad to pieces. But I don't think that's going to happen. If I was in charge of Mr. Fury, that's what would be happening. I don't think that's going to happen. They're going to come out, try and maybe do something clever. Possibly we'll see Southpaw. But I think that was just a gimmick against limited fighters like Martin Rogan, the taxi driver, and Del Boy Chisora. That's his best chance of winning. Tyson Fury's 33-1 to win within the first three rounds. I think that's his best chance of winning. I don't think that they will actually do that. I hope they do. He could easily be knocked down by a jab. He's been knocked down by Cunningham, and I can't even remember the other kid's names.
Patchcheck.
Patchcheck, wasn't he?
Patchcheck, yeah.
I mean, Vlad can be extremely defensive, as we know, and we could easily get to the third or the fourth, maybe the fourth round, without Tyson Fury actually landing a punch. Can his intelligence and attitude handle that? I don't think he can. Fury, I don't know. I just can't see Fury being able to handle it. His chin is massively, massively unproven for me. My bet is on the fight not to go the distance. Iverman by KO, and I say that because Vladimir Klitschko KO is 11-10. Iverman to win by KO is 5-6, and I'm happy to take the shorter price of those two with the insurance of a Fury KO, because I can't get the picture out of my head. Pulev rocked Klitschko bad by a single simple jab in the first round of their fight. One single jab, Klitschko was stiffened up, holding on.
What happened? He turned that fight, ruined him in his head in the same
Absolutely, and that was one of Klitschko's best performances of recent times, and that's why I'm betting on Iverman to win by KO. I'm pretty certain it'll be Vladimir Klitschko, but I'm taking my insurance policy on Iverman to win by KO. Klitschko will win the fight whenever he decides he wants the fight to finish.
Kurt, you've got a question for us all?
Yeah, people are saying, if you notice, that even the guys who are picking Vlad to win, if you see it on like Twitter and everything, whatever happens, Tyson Fury is going to go out on his shield. He's going to leave nothing to chance. He's going to, you know, if it has to be, he's going to go out getting absolutely smashed. But everything that they've just said there was said about David Haye, and what did he do? He blamed his toe. So do you all agree with that Fury will definitely leave it all in the ring, or do you think after five rounds, six rounds, he's behind, maybe he's hurt? He settles for a points loss and
he's a gyppo, man. Come on, that's not going to happen, is it?
I was going to say that. I mean, there's no way he can go back to his gypsy roots and stuff and fucking be the same man. They would crucify him.
I'm worried if he gets sparkoed out in the first three or four rounds about his mental health. I think there could be a meltdown going on Saturday night.
He would disintegrate, wouldn't he?
No, as I say, I really do think if he gets dropped, he'll get up. I think he's that type of guy. Yep. I think he would back up all his chat. Whether or not he can beat Vlad, I mean, we're talking about levels here, and Vlad's proven it, I think. And Dave's going to dispute that, I know that for a fact, right? But you can't deny what Vlad's achieved over his years, right? And it's not his fault he's in a weak era. Christ, people still lay shit at Larry Holmes' door for people that he fought, so you can't really kind of give the guy too much shit for that. But I think this fight is going to go later than people expect. And I could probably see Klitschko get a late stoppage.
How is Vlad going to deal with it mentally when he's unable to catch and hurt Tyson when he's down first couple rounds and Tyson's over there smiling, getting inside his head?
There's no mental comparison, though, is there? I mean, I think Fury, I mean, he could just go completely bananas. Like, you could see him picking up Mick Hennessy and throwing him out the ring.
That's trying, he's back.
You could. The thing is, though, you know, Klitschko's got that old-school Soviet mentality about him. I mean, nothing rattles that guy, you know, honestly. People going on about the fact is, oh, he needed more time to prepare because Fury got into his head at the press conference. What a lot of bullshit.
Crap. No, he needed more time to repair because his training camp was going bad. He wanted to get in better shape.
So you're saying the PEDs are in getting used here, Dave?
Tyson's a threat.
So you're saying PEDs are in use? He wants to cycle off the roids?
Oh, I wouldn't be at all surprised.
Was he cut? Was there any truth in that?
Vitaly's already failed the test. I'm sure he shared with Little Brother, especially after he got made into a little bitch by Lamont Brewster.
Well, Bryn, do you think that's possible, mate? I mean,
yeah, cheers, have some roids.
Yeah, Bryn, what do you think about that? I mean, obviously the old school Soviet style and that's still alive and well in Russia just now. Well, I know if Russia is no Ukraine technically, but I think it's possible.
That he's juicing?
Yeah.
I mean, come on, it's boxing. Like, I mean, what they're doing in terms of vetting these guys, I think you'd be stupid not to cheat at this point, which is terrible, but he looks as ripped as I've ever seen it. Like, I don't understand how these guys get bigger and bigger as they get older, and they get leaner and leaner. So, yeah, I think he deserves a lot of scrutiny. But, I mean, he's, as you say, his brother's tested positive, he hasn't, but, yeah, is it possible? 100%. He'd be stupid not to.
I know one person would probably back you up there. Alex, what do you think, mate? You'd pick on the fight as well?
Yeah, I mean, well, I'm suspicious of pretty much everybody. So, you know, the way testing is these days, you just get away with it so easily. Even the most, scrutinizing of tests, you know, you go to VADA and things like that, even they aren't going to catch you, you know, unless you're doing some sort of a 365 year-round thing. But even then, pay for the best chemist, and you're going to pass that shit anyway. So, and the sort of money Vlad makes,
plus he's got all the officials, he can control them easily.
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, I wouldn't be surprised if Fury's doing the same. I mean, you don't even need body, you know, the state of, I wouldn't call it a state necessarily, Fury's body, but, you know, a ripped physique isn't always the best indicator of, steroid use either. But, on the fight, I think that, you know, I agree with the sentiment that I think this fight's not going to end quickly. You know, I don't think Vlad's ever been the type to really bang his opponents out quickly, even if he does, completely outmatch them. He's always been a very, well, not always, but in the last, 10 years or so, he's been the cautious guy. Stick behind the jab and just break them down, and I think he'll do exactly the same with Fury. I think that, you know, he'll respect the fact that Fury's a much bigger man, and, he's got some range on him, and I think that he appreciates Fury's got some boxing talent for such a big man as well. But ultimately, you know, if it's coming down to a boxing match, who are you going to pick? You've got to pick Vladimir. You just have to. I think that, you know, Fury's only real chance is to make it the rough sort of rough and tumble fight. And if it gets to that, I think, you know, Vlad, with his experience, will come out on top of that. I think that he obviously, you know, we've seen how good he is at spoiling and clinching and covering up if people want to get, you know, a bit rough with him, just as he did with Povetkin. So I honestly can't envisage how Fury wins beyond, you know, the one bomb, one hitter quitter sort of scenario. So Vlad, late stoppage.
Just to let the listeners know, I think the plan is to go live after the fight next Saturday, so you know what that means.
Make sure you're all there for Tyson's victory.
I mean, you know what that means, though, eh?
Oh, you'll be smashed, mate.
Yeah, well, there'll be people wanting me to yeah, like, rekindle my pod from the Bellevue Cleverly fight, you know. After Friday night, though, I don't think I could cope with another drinking marathon. I was absolutely foobard.
What time's the fight starting on Saturday night? UK time, say?
I feel half ten.
It's on Sky Box Office, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, HBO start at quarter quarter to 10 our time, so after intros, but it'll be after 10 o'clock, I'd say.
After 10 o'clock, yeah. If I can just throw, I'll just throw my 2 pence worth in very quickly, because I need to go in a minute. I think it's going the distance. Whenever the fight was first made, I thought, oh, Vlad's going to bang him out in about 4 rounds, you know, Fury's got a bad chin, blah, blah, blah. I do think that he's going out on his shield. I cannot see Fury quitting or dropping without giving it a good go. I think he's going to take the Vlad bombs early, and we might be surprised at how well he takes them. And he could just be taking them all night. It could be one of those fights. I think Vlad's going to win on points, maybe like a 117, 111 or something like that. I think Tyson's going to stand up a lot better and stronger than people think, including myself originally.
Tommy, did I get your pick, mate?
I'm picking Tyson Fury, mate. I think that the big fella doesn't get enough credit for his athleticism. I think he's a very, very talented boxer. He's a talented mover for a big guy. I think Vladimir is absolutely there for the taking. I'm not saying that I would have picked. I'm not basing this on this pick on this being the best ever Vladimir Klitschko, because I think Vladimir's past his prime. I think he looked jaded in the Jennings fight. I think he's here. Tyson's going to beat him. I think Tyson uses his body very well, but you see how Vladimir leans on smaller opponents. Tyson does the same, and he tires him out. I don't know how Vladimir's going to cope with that. I think he's going to account himself very well. He's going to maybe take Vladimir in the later rounds.
Okay.
Can I just say something else here? I'm just actually reading an article on Costamato just now. Did any of you know he was born in the UK?
No, didn't know that, mate. No.
He was born in Ramsbottom.
Is that me? Is that me, Jimmy Savile?
I just caught that, you bastard.
That went out of your head, man.
Did anybody else go right over the head? I actually caught it instantly. Well, no, instantly, but like 5 seconds later.
Yeah.
Bryn, did you catch that one, mate?
Square so.
Oh my god, he's gone.
Bryn away.
Can you blame him?
He's still there. Bryn, did you catch that?
Yeah, I did, and I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Right, I think we need to end it there. Because it's 2 hours, 40 minutes. It's like going back to the very early days of the 3-hour podcasts. What are you saying, mate? Adam?
James De Gale. Lucien Boutte is the most shot fighter you will see in a world title fight this year, not staged in Russia. Shot fighter, De Gale KO, no problem.
No, let's hope for it. Anyway, I'd like to thank the panel today. I forget who's on here. Adam Smith, Steve Wellens, Alex Morris, Tommy Allen, Dave the Hater, Kurt Ward, and big thanks to Donny Baseball and Bryn Jonathan Butler for making a wee interesting debate there, dispute. So really good to get some of that cleared away. And I don't think you'll catch many podcasts discussing what we discussed tonight. So I've been your host, Andy Patterson. We'll probably see you on Saturday with a live show. If not, we'll definitely see you on Sunday. All the best. Cheers.
Tyson Fury, top 1 pound for pound.
American, UK pound for pound number one.